A pleasant good evening to you, ladies and gentlemen, from Good Richfield, where tonight QCTV and QCTV.org are proud to bring you the 83rd Pumpkin Bowl as the White Bear Lake Bears travel on the road to take on the Anoka Tornadoes. Alice Cooper's blaring in the background. It must be Pumpkin Bowl season. Hello, everybody. I'm Tim Anderson, joined alongside, it feels like the equivalent of Frank Gifford and Don Meredith, I think, to my Howard Cosell, Ryan Nelson Kane and Zach Nienaber. Good to have you both here. Ryan, we were out here a couple times last year for this Anoka team. They were veteran. They had seniors. They threw the ball all over the yard, and they had a lot of success. It's a little different this time around. They're younger, sophomores all over the place, but expectations still kind of the same.
Expectations don't change. Of course, at the Pumpkin Bowl, it's always going to be high expectations. You expect to win this game. This is one of those pride moments for these young guys where you can kind of find something to build on for a career as you move forward. A couple of things to note. I talked to Coach Tony Bazal on the field a couple of minutes ago. He said that special teams is going to be a concern tonight, making sure that everything is clean and well executed. But we also get the senior starting left tackle back for the Anoka Tornadoes tonight.
Absolutely. Grant Chapman back in the lineup tonight after missing. They're still down a couple of seniors and some other players that have just been out with injuries. They've been ravaged. On the other side, as you can see, he's wearing the wrong jersey, but that's because he coaches for Coon Rapids. Zach Nienaber, you run the defense over there. Adam Denneke runs the same defense here for Anoka. What do they need to do to slow down this running attack for White Bear Lake tonight?
Well, it'll be exciting to see how he attacks it. The defense is really, you know, the 3-4. He'll bring them some pressure from the outside, really shut down the game, and how they adjust to 3-by-1 will be interesting to see. I grew up watching him on the field as a player. I've coached games against him. It'll be a lot of fun tonight in the booth to get to watch him now and really observe.
Absolutely. Should be a fun one. It's great contrasted styles. These two teams met last year. White Bear Lake really dominated the game and controlled the pace of play. Bo Wasserick told me before the game today that they ran 34 offensive plays only last year, guys. That's got to change for them to be successful. Should be a great one tonight. The White Bear Lake Bears and the Anoka Tornadoes are next on QCTV.
Hey, Dad. 1, 2, 3. You saved me. Dad?
Are you okay?
I'm fine, dear.
Your hero needs you now, and AARP is here to help. Find the care guides you need at aarp.org/caregiving.
You told me not to talk to strangers. You told me not to cross the street without looking both ways.
You told me not to touch the stove.
You told me not to do drugs.
You told me not to drink and drive.
You gave me so many messages about how to stay safe.
Why didn't you keep me safe by properly storing your gun?
Back to the fence, and that's gone.
There it is. Ace to win the set. It's caught. 20, 10, touchdown.
This is going to be in the gap.
Yes, yes, yes.
Scores on an deflection. The Ann Arbor Huskies win their first state championship.
Hey, we're back in the semi-warm press box here at Goodrich Field as the Pumpkin Bowl getting ready to go. There's a look at the trophy. That's what they play for every year. I think that thing's, probably as old as the game. 83 years is what the Pumpkin Bowl is. Tim Anderson, Zach Nienaber, Ryan Nelson Kane as we get set for kickoff here tonight in what should be a really pivotal game, guys, as we get ready to start kickoff tonight. Anoka comes in at 1-4, Ryan, and so as you start to think about getting into the playoffs and playoff seeding, and Zach can talk to this too,
getting these kinds of wins kind of a big deal right now.
Yeah, for a young team like Anoka, it's going to be a lot about execution and confidence tonight. Can they stay consistent with the keys to their game? We know that they're going to throw the ball a lot. We know that they're going to be trying to put the offense through their playmakers tonight. And we know that they're going to be relying on some protections here as White Bear tries to go after that sophomore quarterback.
Yeah, and the section seedings are wide open. In Anoka's section, there's only one team with 5 wins. Everybody else has got 3 wins down to 1. So they're all right with each other, and it'll be interesting to see how it shakes out here over the final 3 weeks of the season.
There's Coach Wasserick tonight playing hurt. See a little bandage on his wrist. A little bit of a mishap last week prior to the game at Moundsview, so he's playing hurt, but he's a battler. I like that about him. So Coach Bo, in his fourth year, and it's a little bit reminiscent of his first year when he took over here. A lot of sophomores were playing then, but as he told me before the game, it's these guys are varsity ready to play as opposed to maybe 4 years ago where a lot of those young guys were learning how to play, and that's a big difference between the two things. We are set to go. Kickoff time. Ryan Bartlett, the head coach for White Bear Lake. Getting ready to go is Cham Kwame, who will kick it away for the Anoka Tornadoes at the 40-yard line.
It's like a couple of group returners back there for White Bear.
And we're ready to roll.
Well, they're stacking the returners here so they make sure that Anoka can't plan ahead of time.
We will see where this is going to go. Kwame's set to go with the kickoff. We are set for the Pumpkin Bowl. There we go. Line drive kick going to be taken on a hop right here, and White Bear Lake's got some room to run and more room to run. Big collision at the 33-yard line, and that's where things will slow down. See if we can get a number on that player who got the return. Might have been, yeah, looks like 14, Vettel Henderson, who got the return right there for White Bear Lake, and he will get them in good shape. A player down for the Tornadoes down at the 28-yard line. Referee and also Heidi Beckendorf, the certified athletic trainer out there. Number 44 on the ground, that's Ian Wittick, the junior.
I hate to see that on the first, really the first kick there. That's a tough sight to see in a pumpkin bowl here.
Big collision right down there at that return. Let's take a look at the defensive starters for Bo Wasserick as we wait on this injury. Carter Nabosny, Max Berglund, Carson Davis, Logan Jungling back in. Zach Anderson, Ian Wittick, who we just saw right there on the ground. Zach Welch, who's much improved. A lot of people were really raving about him. Noah Thielen, Braden Whaling, Wyatt Rothram, and Sawyer Shell are your starters on defense. Sawyer Shell, very, very solid cornerback. Good baseball player, but playing very well for them at the cornerback position.
Saw quite a bit of Sawyer Shell last week, or last year, I should say, when you and I called the Moundsview game in the sections there.
Jack Peterson, Evan Vikstrom, Jack Covisto, Zach Borid, Joel Seifried on the offensive line for Ryan Bartlett. But then you see a 3 running back lineup with Kashawn Lipscomb, Matt Currier, Rayshon Brakes. Vettel Henderson, as we mentioned, is the kind of the lone wide receiver. Josh Dogger at tight end. Gavin Knutson is the quarterback, number 6 for White Bear Lake. Wittick getting off on his own power. That's great to see. Going to go over there with, again, certified trainer Heidi Beckendorf.
Well, we talked before the game, White Bear has games where they've run for 300 yards. They've had games where they throw for 300 yards. So we'll see what their approach is here tonight against the Tornado defense.
Yeah, they kind of mix it up. As you were talking to Adam Denneke before the game, Zach, you see a little bit of wing tee, some old school stuff, and then you see him spread it out. It's kind of different.
Yep, you'll see him here start with a wing tee look.
Wing tee look, Knutson ready to go. It looks like it might be Brakes in the backfield. They send Currier in motion. Actually, they're going to hand it off this time. Lipscomb, and he's got room to run. Lipscomb to the outside. He'll take it to the 46-yard line. That's going to be a quick pickup of 10 and perhaps a first down for the White Bear Lake Bears to open the game. Lipscomb very speedy through that zone ride.
Zach, what's the challenge of defending a wing tee offense?
Well, the key to stopping it is following the guards. The guards will take you to the ball, so you'll see there the guard pulls around and the fullback falls in right up the hole.
Good start for White Bear Lake. They get a first down on the Lipscomb carry. He'll stay in the backfield. They come in motion once again, and they'll go straight ahead with Lipscomb, who's got room to go and more than that. He's got the 30 and the 20. It's going to be a race to the finish. Can they get him? Yes, they can. Down at the 4-yard line, a big run for Kashawn Lipscomb, and a nice pursuit that time from number 29 to not give up on the play for Anoka. That would be Bennett Overby, I believe, who came up and caught him.
Well, and that was just the same play back to the opposite side there by White Bear.
I think that was 23, and it looks like he's down hurt.
Yeah, 23. You take that
Braden
back.
Whaling.
Thank you, Braden Whaling. Great pursuit by Whaling to catch up on that one. But, yes, that was a big stop. Look, man, you got the
maybe the wind knocked out of him on that one. I don't know, but that was a big collision at the end, and Lipscomb showing you some burst.
Also shows you why you don't celebrate before you cross the goal line, Tim.
That's a good point as well. Wheeling is down, so hopefully we will find out on him very soon. 11:19 to play, opening quarter just underway. Two plays run by this White Bear Lake team, but both very effective. And again, the deception is there on that wing tee. That's the key to it. There's a look at Windy tonight. Hey, Windy.
Anytime you can get the defense moving side to side, you want to do it. I mean, you're going to create some holes that way, especially if you're trying to run north-south. That fullback's going to have room as long as that defense is moving laterally. But Zach's right. I mean, you follow the guards, you should be able to defend that pretty well.
Yeah, there was a great kickout block there by 61 Evan Vikstrom.
So they're going to bring Whaling off, and he's moving a little gingerly here as well. So Knutson's got the play. They're going to come back in. It's first down and goal to go. Right away, two plays into this game. We've had a couple players already go out for the Tornadoes. A bit of a tough start. And now White Bear Lake looking to slam it home here for a quick touchdown to start this thing. Staying in that wing tee. Knutson will go under center again and hand it straight ahead. Lipscomb once again straight to the two, maybe the one. He'll be stopped short, second down and goal to go.
This is where if you're Anoka, you can't get sucked into what you're seeing right now, because that's how they're going to get you over the top. They're going to lull you with that fullback dive over and over again if they can get it. Once you stop it, they're going to look for something else.
So clock moving here as we line up again. Second down, goal to go. Not much difference. Lipscomb just sitting about 2 yards behind the quarterback, Knutson. Knutson will hand it again. Straight ahead dive, and they're going to get in. Touchdown, White Bear Lake. Off to a great start. What a great drive for Gavin Knutson and the Bears, and they take the early 6-0 lead.
Kind of a tough drive there for the Anoka defense. We'll see if they can respond here on offense, but you know, we talk about they're a young team kind of seeking that consistency and execution, and you really didn't see it on that drive there. Well executed by White Bear Lake, but we'll see if Anoka can respond with this young offense.
Nothing special there, Zach, just a really straight ahead run out of that offensive set.
Yeah, I didn't see any pull action on that one.
So total drive, four plays, 66 yards, 1 minute and 14 seconds on that one. Pretty easy going for the White Bear Lake Bears, and now an opportunity for the Tornadoes to answer on offense. For Anoka this year, it's a young offense, but they've been in a lot of the games they've played. It's not like they're getting, you know, overmatched all the time. They really should have beaten Forest Lake. They had them beat late in the third, late in the fourth quarter, ended up giving that one away. I know that's one that bothers Coach Bowe. And obviously last week's game against Moundsview just felt like just a cavalcade of difficulties. They had a bus not show up on time, and all that stuff just seems to be working against them. Injuries like crazy this year, losing Terrell Cummings in week one. Evan Frecking started the year at quarterback. He was gone by week two. So it's been a lot.
We ran into Anoka in 7-on-7. We didn't play this year, but we're both in the same league, and you could tell they're extremely athletic.
Well, this goes back to what you were saying at the beginning of the game, too, where, you know, Coach Bowe started his time at Anoka with a team that was full of sophomores, but this team, they've been in his system for a little while. They know what he's trying to run. They know what the standard is, and hopefully they can execute that tonight.
All right, ready to go here for White Bear Lake as they'll kick it off with Treichel, and they kind of squib one, and that's going to be caught on the hands team there. Good job by 42 Brennan Smith, who's able to secure that one for the Tornadoes. So Anoka's going to get good field position. An interesting move there to try to sneak one past Anoka.
Well, I think they saw a little dead spot in the zone, but the kick didn't quite get where they were trying to get it to. And for the Tornadoes, that means great field position.
Now we'll see if they can convert, but you kind of wonder if maybe this is a sign that they trust their defense a little bit to take that risk.
Let's take a look. There's Peyton Padani. He's the quarterback for the Anoka Tornadoes. He's the sophomore. He will lead them on offense tonight. He will throw it, and he's got a very good arm. That's one thing they like about him, and he's throwing on first down, trying to get it out towards Eli Paulson, but that's going to be missed. But they say that's a backwards pass. They're going to call that a live ball. White Bear Lake's got a chance to score, and they will. The officials have not ruled here. It looks like they're going to say touchdown, that was a backward pass, but I think Coach Bowe's trying to say, no, that was a forward pass. And let's see what the call is. It looks like they're going to say touchdown, and Coach Bowe's not thrilled.
Yeah, we'll have to take another look at that one. I thought that one was forward live, but
tough break there for Anoka. And I know we talked to Coach Bartlett before the game. They were looking for those screen balls. That was one of his keys to the game. So to come out and go play one to the screen to the right there, that was expected. That's probably what they were coaching all week, is that they expected with a sophomore quarterback they were going to be throwing those screens.
So they call that. It's a live ball and a turnover, and we want to get a look at that in just a second, but I think if you're Coach Bo, that is nightmarish of a start right there. As they were trying to get that ball out on a quick screen, it got blown up. But they're going to say that that was just a kind of a lateral per se, but they say that that pass was backwards, not forwards.
I mean, even if it's along the same line, that counts as a backward pass, correct? I mean, that's that you've got to know that you, if you're a receiver, you've got to get on that. You can't just get knocked down and not go after that ball. You've got to be aware of your situation.
Let's take a look again. So he's throwing it. And that is
clearly forward.
That
feels like a full yard or
he
two.
He throws that from the 34, and the collision's at the 35. That's a tough call.
So that's a tough one to take here on the first possession. And already we've only played a minute and 39 seconds, and we're down. And the Tornadoes are down 14-0 here.
Yeah, this is one of those situations where if you've got a young team, you've kind of got to, you know, start the game over a little bit here. You know, short memory, come out, play clean. You got a tough call there, but that's high school football, man. You're going to have that sometimes. You got to be able to adjust and kind of overcome some adversity here.
So they've got to try to put that behind them and see if they got plenty of game. That's the good news here, right? There's plenty of time to try to get a score back and see if you can get this thing to 14-7, maybe knot it up before the half. So USA out on the other side for the student section of White Bear Lake. They are here. Good thing they decided not to wear orange.
Well, they're having fun tonight so far.
Because it's an orange out on the other side. Yeah, for sure. It's a very quiet Anoka crowd here on a chilly night for the Pumpkin Bowl. And we're going to try this again. Another kind of pooch kick. Not much on it. Going to be taken at the 25. Chance for Anoka to get a return here.
They're out of their lanes.
As they try to take it to the outside. And there's some daylight down the sidelines. Some room to run for the Tornadoes. And they're going to get across the 50. Could almost get a late hit call there, but no flag on the play. They're going to get good field position. A great return from Zach Welch.
Yeah, White Bear got a little hungry there. You know, they overcommitted on that side of the field. They got out of their lanes, didn't play contain on the outside there, and just able to cut that back and kind of run that up toward the 50-yard line.
Yeah, Anoka set up a good wall along the sideline, and I mean, it definitely looks like a late hit, too, out of bounds.
So they'll get first down and 10 for Padani, who will come back in after that tough opening series after the fumble and return, scoop and score touchdown. So we'll see what the Tornadoes can do inside of White Bear Lake territory to start their second possession of the night. 14-0 White Bear Lake. Padani sits in the shotgun with Mossman next to him. Back to pass. Padani's going to look, going open over the top, but the guy can't get it to him. Good look that time as it was Afiabekwe who was open. The young sophomore wide receiver had a step on the outside corner as you look at the defense for Ryan Bartlett's team. Jonte Vouch, Nick Asper, Demarion Pollard, Tolu Akunle, Chris Heim, Imiello Stanton, Aiden Atkins, Devin Mueller, Michael Delaney, Dom Anderson, and Bennett Gilson. So second down coming up for the Tornadoes. Padani looks back. That's the customary move. Their look back for coach's call. And now there's pressure. And he is sacked. Good pursuit that time from Imiello Stanton. And Imiello Stanton will pick up a big time loss for the Tornadoes. And that'll make him third and forever here.
It looked like a miscommunication up front there. Anoka maybe looked like they were trying to set up a screen and just nobody materialized there. And
well, he starts pre-snap on the right. And then as Anoka looks back, he comes over to the left-hand side of the ball. And it makes for a difficult pickup.
Tough spot there for this young offense here. Let's see if maybe they can rally and get some field position, maybe get a first down here. But I think really you're just trying to improve your field position for a punt here.
Send a man in motion this time as they send a Beckwe in motion. Padani's airing it out down the sidelines. Got a man, can't get it to him. Again, a little bit of an opening and a step that time. It might have been pulsing down the sidelines for Anoka. And that's going to bring up fourth down. Good look from Padani, just couldn't quite get it to him.
Eli Paulson, another one of those guys that you and I saw last year who was just all over the field in that game against Moundsview. Off to a good start there on that play. You just got to connect on that ball if you're on Padani there.
So they will punt. Back on to punt.
So White Bears got too many guys on the field here.
Okay, so get a penalty this time.
Good ball, illegal substitution on the defense. 5-yard penalty. Still fourth down.
So that'll move it back for 5 yards. Still probably punting, I would guess, right here.
Yeah, Austin Gibson was running off the field late there.
So we'll punt it again, but this time from a little bit closer. Sham Kwame will punt. As he sits at his 37-yard line. Snaps good. Punts on its way. Good one. Low bullet. We'll take a bounce. Take an Anoka bounce and go out of bounds at about the 14-yard line, pinning back the White Bear Lake Bears, and maybe a chance for everybody to take a breath here. A quick start for White Bear Lake. They get up 14-0, and now they get the offense back to work again as they look for kind of an early knockout punch here.
Well, the story of the first drive was fullback trap. All right, they were trapping the five technique, so we'll see if there's an adjustment made here, if they want to come out maybe in a little bit of different front, or how they adjust to that, because if you're White Bear Lake, you're probably going to keep running it until someone stops it.
Absolutely. If you're looking at this right now and you know that that's what they're trying to run here with that more another one of that wing T look, I mean, this, you've got to kind of key on that fullback here and watch those guards.
Start moving a guy in motion again, but they'll go Lipscomb again as, again, they try that little misdirection move, but straight ahead with Lipscomb. Not much that time. Picks up a yard, maybe two, before he's brought down by the interior line of the Tornadoes.
Looked fairly similar to that goal line play that they called down on the two down there to score. The right guard kind of came out and just kind of stopped. Didn't look like he was really looking to hit anybody there. Just trying to seal, and there just wasn't anybody there.
Yeah, that's more of a wham block from the wing there on an iso look instead of a trap where they had their two big gains.
Second down and seven. Knutson brings him to the line. Big kid. Gavin Knutson under center once again. It's Courier in motion. They'll go straight ahead. Lipscomb, who gets the bulk of the carries, and you can see why. Not trying to get uber creative with this wing T, running a lot of that straight ahead running. It'll pick up a third down and six coming up.
Yeah, if you're Anoka, you've got your linebackers playing very aggressive on the last couple of plays here. You got to make sure that you're cognizant of the idea that it's third and seven, and they might try to hit you with a little misdirection, might try and throw the ball here a little bit. You've got to stay on your cues and make sure that you know what's coming.
Third down. Anoka finally has them in a down that I think they can do something with aggressively on defense. We'll see. Back sitting a little bit more of a shotgun, kind of a pistol formation. Now Knutson spins around and then hands it again. A nice little play there. You talked misdirection. There it was. And they're going to get a first down out to the 35-yard line. That was a pretty interesting little play call there. And it worked out nicely.
Kind of a shotgun wing there look from White Bear Lake.
Yep, it's a counter play back. They've got the tight end and the wing pulling on it. And it's a tough play to stop, especially when you've been worried about stuff going to the strong side the whole time.
Yeah, Rayshon breaks on the carry that time. Just kind of beat the brakes off the Tornadoes defense that time and picks up a first down. And this White Bear team that wasn't afraid to throw it last week doesn't feel the need to do that this week. They have been running exclusively here in this opening quarter. Handed off Courier, his first carry of the game, trying to turn it around, gets 2-3 yards out to the 38-yard line before being brought down.
Running the ball gives you control, and it gives you security for the most part as long as you guys hold on to the ball. And if you can get the yardage you need around the ground, you'd rather have it on the ground.
Definitely in a cool night like this, doesn't hurt you to do that.
It's not quite as risky to run the ball. You don't have to count on that ball in the air and missing something up front.
So we set up a crucial second down and seven once again. 6:50, clock runs, opening quarter. Knutson will sit back in that pistol. Bring Courier in motion, fake the handoff. Now it's going to be a look at for Gavin Knutson. Can he turn the corner? Yes, he can. He's got room to run across the 40 to the 45, down to the 49-yard line, before finally pushed out of bounds that time by Braden Whaling, who's back on the field. Knutson this time maybe a little bluff pass, but he decides he's going to keep it and ends up being very effective.
Yeah, a little bit of a sort of arsenal here showing up for White Bear. They're just, everybody who touches the ball seems able to move the ball, and I mean, that can be a confidence killer for your defense, especially for a young team like Anoka.
First down and 10 now, ball near midfield at the 49-yard line. Now they've opted to switch things up. No wing T look again, staying in that kind of pistol shotgun look. Hand off, it's Lipscomb. Across the 50, he'll take it to the 47 of Anoka. And they are doing exactly what they want to do right now. White Bear Lake in a nice little rhythm.
Seems to be running the same few plays here from different looks, just trying to kind of making that Anoka defense uncomfortable. Zach, you can correct me if I'm wrong on that, but it looks like they're just continuing to run the same handful of plays that are working over and over again.
Well, I think if you can give the illusion of complexity but keep it simple for your offense, that's really what you want to do, right? It makes it difficult for the defense to come out with all those different looks.
Back under center again is Knutson. Second down and about five, maybe a long five. Handoff Courier. Courier runs into his own guy, and that gets blown up at the line of scrimmage that time. Nothing doing. Good pursuit by the Tornadoes that time. Able to get a stop on defense. Noah Phelan on the stop, the senior.
Another player down for Anoka again here.
Goodness gracious. Rough start for this Tornado team. I think it might be 50.
Grayson Saline.
Yeah. 52 down on the ground right now. Grayson Saline. Good kid. Junior, 6'1", 230. And the third player down. Now, the good news is we did see Braden Whaling get back into the game. So that's a good sign for some of these injuries that they've taken early, but might have got rolled up on that one.
Well, it's just some of that great work from Heidi Beckendorf there.
She's busy. Heidi Beckendorf's busy tonight. There's no question about that. One thing, too, I feel like this kind of happens a lot when you're with these misdirection teams. I don't know if you can think about that, Zach, but as players start to go one direction and kind of move that way and maybe have to move back quickly, it feels like that's where we get these entanglements.
Yeah, and it's a downhill running game, right? It's going to be physical up front. And it's, you know, it's a little chilly out, right? The weather has turned. Not that we've had a great Friday night yet this year, I don't feel like it. It's been cold and rain almost every time, but it definitely impacts the play out there.
Salem walking off pretty gingerly there.
Yeah, no doubt about that. We'll keep an eye on him. Good kid. In my debate class, for the record. Just thought I'd say that. Full disclosure. Third down and five. Nice kid. Hand off again, and there's Lipscomb one more time. First down. Boy, what a workhorse that kid is. Really impressive with him early on. And he's got a burst. That first step's really good.
Yeah, in a wing T offense, that fullback can be a major weapon for you. You get the misdirection moving back and forth. That, you know, you kind of freeze those linebackers, and you have the different blocking things up front that can make your life hell a little bit on defense, and you got a physical back there. It can make for a long night. So hopefully Anoka can find some confidence builders here and start to attack a little bit more than they have so far.
Well, certainly defensive coordinator Adam Denneke and that defensive staff have their hands full with this right now. Down 14. Hand off again. Lipscomb straight ahead through. And, ooh, is that, I thought maybe the ball was out for a second, but nope, he's brought down. 4 yard pickup, maybe five. And they're just content to just take it 4 or 5 yards at a time here.
Zach, you're in this situation, you're down 14-0, you're getting the ball run down your throat a little bit. What adjustments are you trying to make as a coach in this situation?
Well, I think you got to try to take something away, right? What are the first thing we're going to take away? And obviously, they're having a lot of success inside run game. You know, and Anoka just has the two down linemen, right? They've got the stand-up guys on the end, but
Knutson throws as he was pursued heavily, hit as he threw, and that's incomplete. White Bear might have done him a favor by throwing on that down, trying to do something different, but instead you get him into a third and sort of long here.
You know, just to complete that thought, it looks almost more like a 4-2-5 right now. And that creates some different, you know, issues against the wing T team. So.
Sure. Knutson took a shot on that play, too.
Sure did. Yeah, sure did. Great pursuit that
Zach
time.
Zach Anderson just put his shoulder pad right in his ribs on that throw.
I'm sure he was looking forward to that. Been waiting to get something like that going. Here we go now with a big third down and six. The handoff and room for breaks as he gets to the corner, to the 30, down to the 25, to the 20 before he's hit out of bounds. Rayshon breaks again when they need a big third down. There he is to get it. That's the second time he's had the play call and the second time he's come through on a third down.
Well, so far this offense has been all gas, no breaks, but we see the breaks there, and then they end up going faster. I don't know how that works.
I see what you did there.
Got to throw the pun in there sometimes.
I like that. Anytime you can work puns into a broadcast, I'm a big believer in it, as you know. Always love a pun. A pun is good.
It keeps the people engaged.
I like a good metaphor. If we can get a metaphor later on, that'd be nice, too.
I'll start working on that.
Work on some metaphors. Let's mix it up a little bit. 4 minutes, 10 seconds. Stock still running. Here's Courier to the outside. Nice little open field tackle that time. Coming up to make a big play was Noah Thielen in the backfield, and they needed that. Second down and long, and a stop here is crucial for the Tornadoes.
Yeah, it's going to be kind of tough sledding to go down 21-0 against a team that's running the ball down your throat. Going to be, especially if you can't control the ball on offense, you go three and out again, you're starting to get in some dangerous territory there early in the game even here. Not even out of the first quarter yet.
Second down and 9.5 or so to go. as Knutson brings him back to the line. They put Henderson out wide, way wide this time, but that's just for show as they go straight ahead again. And it's Keyshawn Lipscomb who will pick it up towards the first down marker at the 11, and yep, they'll give it to him. First down, White Bear Lake. The Bears are having a good year, 3-2, and their two losses have been close losses where they feel like they had chances to win both of those games. So this team, you know, on paper, they think they're better than that 3-2 marker, and right now they're kind of showing some of that.
And they played really well last week against a good Stillwater team.
Important to note here that they can get another first down before they get to the end zone here.
And they're going to go Courier. A little off-tackle move, and he's going to get it out towards the 8-yard line, maybe the 7. You're right. They can get a first down because they can get it at about the 1.5.
That makes for a difficult situation for a defense that might be looking to get off the field here, where they may play a little bit more aggressive down near the goal line, looking to go up that third touchdown here.
This is exactly kind of how last year sort of played itself out. Not a lot of plays getting a chance to be run by Coach Wasserich's offense for Anoka, and you're seeing a lot of ball control now for White Bear Lake. Second down and 6. Hand it off again. It's Brakes. Brakes going to cut it back up the middle, and he's got room. Touchdown, White Bear Lake. Beautiful little move there to cut that back up the middle instead of taking it to the outside. And it ends up being a score for Rayshon Brakes as he turns that back up the middle for the easy TD.
Just a beautiful cut there by Brakes to see that hole and move it up toward the goal line. It's exactly what you coach him to do in that situation, try to get north and south as quickly as possible.
Extra point is good, but they might have, did they blow the whistle first? I'm not seeing any signals. We'll see what they want to do. Looks like we might do this again. We'll see. We'll wait for our officials.
And this is kind of the danger of playing the sort of fast offense that Anoka likes to play with a young offense, is you get off the field quickly, your defense starts to get tired.
Defense, half the distance to the goal line.
It's just a difficult situation to be in as a team. You'd like to think that throwing the ball more, you can be a little bit more explosive, but when you're not connecting on the passes deep down the field, you're not controlling the ball, and you're playing against an offense that can run the ball really, really well, it becomes really difficult to try and come back in a game like this. You've got to play disciplined and hit your marks. You've got to hit your throws. You've got to catch the ball. You've got to make your blocks if you're the offensive line. Everything has to be perfectly executed from here on out, or you're not going to win this game.
15-play drive, ate up almost 7 minutes of clock. They went 80-some yards down the field. Pretty impressive stuff for this White Bear Lake team.
Worth noting, it's still early.
Yeah, very early still. 2:26 to play in the first quarter.
I think you touched on it, though, Tim. The concern is the Anoka defense has been on the field now a lot.
Yep.
Right? They've been on the field for 20 plays already here in the first half, or in the first quarter. And the offense has been out there for 4 plays. So you're hoping here you can sustain a drive a little bit, give your defense a break.
You got to get a first down.
Yeah.
You can't get into situations where you're in 3rd and 15, 3rd and 20 again, where you're hucking the ball deep and trying on a prayer to make that throw from a sophomore quarterback who's only in his 4th start. That's a really difficult position to put your offense in. It's a really difficult position to put your quarterback in.
Fascinating. I'm always fascinated by the music choices at stadiums. Going with the Disturbed version of The Sound of Silence at your own home ballpark. Interesting move. Another little pooch kick short to the 21-yard line, trying to get some room here to turn, and there is more room again. Out to the 40. Can they turn it back? They can. Out to the 45, 46-yard line. That time, Eli Paulson runs that back to the 46-yard line. An interesting move to kick it short like this, especially when Anoka's got the opportunity to get good field position for the third straight time today. Let's see if they can do something with it.
Well, watching the kicking game and pregame, I don't know that there is another option. I felt like he just didn't have a ton of leg when he was watching warm-ups, so that might be where they're at.
I will say, watching warm-ups in that same vein, if we ever see White Bears punter tonight, he looked pretty good.
Well, maybe he should try the kickoff. Maybe they can get that thing down past the 20.
Different
we'll see.
Sort of mechanics, Tim.
Yeah, you might be onto something there. Padani back to work once again. Peyton Padani, the young sophomore, played for some basketball at the varsity level last year as just a freshman. Now they're coming. Big-time blitz pressure. Padani wants to air it out down the field. Got a guy open, and it is caught by Paulson. Eli Paulson complete to the 25-yard line. As for the second straight time, they get a
first
step, and Padani's down.
Rushing the quarterback.
And then we'll get a penalty on top.
First down.
Add 15 more as Padani is down. Referee makes the call. It's roughing the passer. We're going to get 15 more as referee Tim Litvin makes that call.
Boy, that's a tough break for Anoka here. That's about your thinnest position at this point.
Yeah, you're right. Right now the backup is right now. Dre Ellis is listed as the backup. But let's see, is Coach Bo going out to take a look at this and look at Padani? He'll probably have to come off for sure for a play at the very least, and we'll see how this looks.
At least worth noting here that Dre Ellis is listed as a 5'7", 140-pound freshman.
So it could be Trey Borchers, too, who's also listed on the depth chart at quarterback, who plays a lot of wide receiver for them. But we'll see where they go. They got Dre Ellis kind of throwing right now. So
seeing the replay there, it wasn't terribly late, but he definitely came up high through the forearms into him.
His head kind of, you saw the head kind of bounce off the turf there a little bit. Hope he's okay.
Yeah, that's a concern.
Well, Wiper Lake has definitely shown they're going to bring pressure. They're going to play man on the outside, and here we come.
But wow. we did just see that opens you up to. You're going to have one-on-one matchups on the outside there.
Let's see if we can take a look at the hit. Yeah, coming up a little high right there.
The head didn't hit quite as hard as I thought, but that wrist looks like it's the problem. He kind of came down hard on that left wrist.
So
does not look like it's his throwing hand, so if they can get that wrapped up, hopefully he'll be okay.
Well, Heidi Beckendorf's busy tonight, no question about that. Padani looks like he's going to be okay right now because he's kind of moving away from the trainer, or let's see what they want to do. But now it's Dre Ellis's show. So young freshman, number 20, it's a little smaller in stature, a little different look. Let's see what they want to do.
Probably run the ball here and get your quarterback back in there.
And Anoka's going to take a timeout.
Timeout, Anoka, their first charge timeout.
So a timeout taken, and now you can see Coach Bo's got to really do some teaching here and coaching up this young man really quickly here. I don't think he anticipated having to go to this kind of move this quickly.
Well, he's not thrilled because first the down markers were not in the right spot, so they were resetting that, and they put the ball down, and he felt like he should have gotten the play clock pumped there. I would say he has not been a fan of the crew so far.
I would say it has not gone well, yes. We'll take a look at the rankings coming up here. For 3A, or 4, I take that back, for the top 10 Metro. I'm in the wrong thing. I'm thinking volleyball again. Maple Grove up top, 5-0 coming into this one. Rosemont at 5-0 as well. Stillwater, that very good Stillwater team you talked about, 5-0. And our little screen likes to move in and out up here. Eden Prairie also right there. What else is new? Forest Lake is the real, having just a wonderful season at 5-0. Shakopee, again, very good at 4-1. And a lot of the usual suspects in there, Lakeville South as well. It's a very strong top. All right, Dre Ellis, it's your show. Waits in the shotgun. They'll give. Mossman gets a look, and he'll carry it and take it down to about the 10-yard line, just a little short of the 10, pickup of a couple, as Ethan Mossman got his first look of the night. Take a live look at the Maple Grove Wyzetta game right now. Wyzetta is up 14-0, as you can see, thanks to our guys at CCX for bringing us the live look in. Crimson on the ropes early, look out.
I gotta tell you, as a coach in that building, the expectation is they're winning a state championship this year.
We're going end zone with the kid, Ellis to the end zone, caught. Touchdown! A great little throw right there, and they get a touchdown. Flag on the play, caught by Trey Borchers.
I'm going to bet this is on the defense. They're throwing that ball down to the 2-yard line.
The sophomore Trey Borchers, a fantastic catch as he hooks up with Dre Ellis. The freshman at 5'7".
Holding defense.
Yep.
Touchdown.
They will go ahead and call that one good. And a touchdown for the Tornadoes. A big answer there. And Ellis with his first touchdown pass.
This is what we just talked about, too, that one-on-one matchup on the outside. You know they're going to bring pressure against your young quarterback. Just get the ball, get it out, and trust your guy to make a play.
Interesting to run it now. They do a lot of goofy stuff around here, maybe running a two-point conversion. Now they might bring in the kicking game. Yeah, that's what it looks like, mixing it up. Lots of different stuff here. They got guys coming in from everywhere. What is happening here on this field? Finally, we get everybody square, and it's going to be an extra point for Kwame, potentially. Snap, spot, kick, blocked. You know, I think they like to go for two a lot. I don't know if they just opted against it there at the end. Three plays, 54 yards for the Tornadoes, but that was an interesting little decision.
Well, it looked like they had set up a swinging gate and didn't get the look that they liked.
There was the touchdown. Nice little play by Trey Borchers to bring that in on a pretty good throw from Ellis. Take another look at it. Big score right there, though, guys, right? To get that, get it back to 21-6. You got to at least feel like you got a little life again. What a first quarter.
Yep, and now you just need to stop, right? Defense comes out, makes a stop, and you're right back in the game.
Well, and they've had plenty of rest now. You've had an opportunity to get a little bit of water in your system, get a breather, sit down for a minute, get your legs back.
Well, I don't know about plenty of rest. That was a minute of game clock that got burned up right there. But you're right. It was a few minutes of time where they had the injury to the quarterback, that kind of thing. Well, I'll tell you what. We also learned in that two plays, Coach Wasrick's not changing anything. Doesn't matter who he's throwing in the game. They're going to pass. They're going to do their stuff.
For sure. The defense had time to, you know, go over some adjustments. You know, there's nothing worse than when your offense goes three and out, because a lot of times you've got some defensive guys on the punt team, so they're getting ready to go out for punt on third down, and you don't have a lot of time to make adjustments. Now with that penalty that's putting the ball all the way up to the 45, I would onside kick.
Really?
Because even if you don't get it, you're still going to put the ball at about the 30-yard line, 35, right? I feel like that's the move here. I guess the ball's going to be on the 50.
Our young fans here at the game tonight, that's nice to see that as well. They seem excited here. We'll see if they're actually watching football. That would be even more swell, but they look like they're having a great time here tonight at Goodrich Field. It is the Pumpkin Bowl, last home game of the season for the Anoka Tornadoes. They're on the road the rest of the way, including the battle for the paddle on a Thursday afternoon over MEA break. That's going to be an interesting one. They will kick it deep and just take the touchback. But that's an interesting call, right? That's always a judgment call for a coach. It's all about how do you feel? Do you like the look? Do you like your hands, team? How does that come together?
Yeah, I think you know, in my head, I say if depends on what I have for onside kicks or surprise kicks. But if I feel confident in one, you know, even if you don't get it, you're still going to put the ball, you know, about the 35-yard line, and it gives you a chance to get the ball back. You know, it might be worth a shot, especially in a game where you're trailing. But if you trust your defense here, that's nothing wrong with that too, right?
Yep.
Defensive coordinator loves having the ball back there too. So,
isn't there a thought too, Ryan, that that coach might be sniffing it out on the other side as well? Like Ryan Bartlett is seeing the field position and saying, hey, let's watch that and keep an eye out for that here?
Well, it looked like they had
a spread on first down, and they hand it off. Can they cut back? Oh, Brakes looking for some room here. Boy, look at the nifty moves from Rayshon Brakes, but finally the Tornadoes bottle him up on a spread look that time.
Yeah, just to finish that thought, it looked like they may have been looking toward the middle of the field here. It's kind of a soft little hole in the kick return area for White Bear there, but they had a man up front. They were ready for it. Again, you talk about the swing pass for the potential two-point conversion. Just didn't look like they got the look they wanted. So hopefully the defense can come out here and get a stop. Obviously, that first down play went for a little bit further than you'd hope it would go on defense, but hopefully you can bottle it up here.
Yeah, Brakes is, with Brakes and Lipscomb, they've got a really interesting little 1-2 punch there, and Courier seems to be more of a kind of a big bulldozer type.
From wing tee to empty.
Look at that. Back to pass, throwing Knutson, that's caught. Complete right there towards number 11. That's Travis Domshot making his first catch of the day, a senior wide receiver, 5'11". And he gets a first down for the White Bear Lake Bears. So Coach Bartlett, who did say to us in pregame that, you know, I'm not a big balance guy. I'll have it if we can have it, but it's not something I require. We'll do whatever we have to do to win. You kind of like that.
Well, even without the balance so far, they've kind of had the Anoka defense on their heels a little bit, which is a difficult spot to be in if you're a defense.
There's the end of the first quarter. Not able to get that play off before the end of the quarter, and a wild one indeed on QCTV. The White Bear Lake Bears get three scores. Tornadoes answer at the end. It's 21-6 after one on QCTV.
STEM is precise. No margin for error.
Dare to forget that. Dare to have fun with it. Get weird with it. Dare to send those old STEM theories flying past the neighbor's house into outer space. Dare to program something internet-breaking, record-breaking. Dare to blow their minds. Dare to learn the difference between sedimentary and metamorphic rock. Go find those rocks. Dare to keep daring. Dare to STEM. Check out She Can STEM to get started.
Hey, welcome back, everybody. QCTV, QCTV.org. Tim Anderson, Ryan Nelson, Kane, Zach Nienaber with you. Three-man booth. Just three-man band, if you will. Love it. It's like Three Dog Night. I'll just come up with all the different three analogies we can come up with here to get us working here in this first one. Big first quarter for the for the White Bear Lake Bears as we take a look at the first quarter recap. It got started with a little Keyshawn Lipscomb action as he runs that one straight ahead, almost to the house before he was brought down there at the end. They run it in. They get the big score. Padani then turns it over on the next play as we get to live action going on the other side of the screen. They ended up running it back on a scoop and score fumble that a little bit of a tough call for the Tornadoes. Second down. Coming up for the
unsportsmanlike.
71 unsportsmanlike.
Ooh.
Unsportsmanlike on White Bear Lake. Back him up. I believe that, yeah, they're going to back
71.
Him up. 71 on that one gets the call. That would be Joel Seifried, senior O-lineman. So those three big plays, though, got him up 21-0 before the big answer by Anoka towards the end of the first quarter. We're at 21-6.
Well, and that was a post play penalty there, so now we're in second and 25, and now this is a big spot here for the Tornadoes. They got to force a punt.
So during the recap, this is the play where it happens, and 71's right there, and he might coming in after the play with some extracurricular stuff.
Just
maybe jawed. Oh, it was a little jaw action.
Gave a point at the scoreboard there.
Oh, that's what it was. That's no good. Pass incomplete as Henderson was trying to get a quick hit outside. And the Anoka Tornado bench is up in arms about something. Coach Wasserick's not happy.
Well, he wants to call the fumble.
Yeah, he wanted, a fumble there on that one, not the first one.
Maybe a Bronx cheer from Coach Wasserick on the sidelines. And there's a look at the orange out from the student section tonight.
I know you're up 21-6, but these are the mistakes you can't make in the first half and let a team back into the game.
A third down and 25, and if you're Anoka, you're just trying to keep it in front of you here. In the shotgun, Knutson waits. Oh, boy, they all jumping. Everybody's jumping. We'll see if it's a jump on Anoka or a jump on White Bear Lake.
I believe this is going to be on the Tornadoes here. I didn't see anybody move.
Dead ball penalty, encroachment on the defense, number 54.
So the Tornadoes.
Five-yard penalty, third down.
Tornadoes try to time the snap, and instead they jump as they were looking to come, bringing the house right there, it looked like.
I appreciate the aggression, but I think in this situation it would have been better just to make sure that you're doing your job.
Yeah, Carter Nabosny right there trying to get the leap for the Tornadoes, trying to get in that backfield. Now it sets up a third down and 20. Still a long way to go. Braden Whaling trying to get in position on the outside as they spread it out once again. Trying to bring pressure. Tornadoes a little overzealous here, trying to time this. Almost jumped a second time. And now they're looking to bring pressure to Knutson here. Step back throw. Complete it. Can they get some room on this one? No, they're not going to get to the first down marker. Not even close, but they pick up a few yards to make it a little more manageable of a punt. Tornadoes get the stop they need right there, and they force the very important three and out as Zach Welch comes up to make the tackle.
So we saw a 4-2-5 look from Anoka on the previous drive, and they were definitely more of a 3-4 look there. So that's their first adjustment of the game here, and now we'll see what White Bear counters with the next time they come out.
I believe that's Paulson back to receive this punt.
Always dangerous.
And they get a chance again with good field position here, you would think, for the Tornadoes. Oh, punt almost blocked, and maybe it was partially blocked as that punt goes nowhere. It's out of bounds inside White Bear Lake territory, and the Tornadoes have some options here as we take another look. Did this get blocked? Yeah, I don't know. It didn't.
Maybe a fingertip.
Maybe. But that's a...
It was enough.
That's a...
So they're going to put the ball down on the 40 here, but I thought it was even shorter of that. I mean, that thing went straight sideways into the student section almost.
Like a Ryan Nelson Kane sand wedge. That thing just shanked hard to the right. And
they're not paying me enough for the drive here.
And there's a good sign. There's Peyton Padani back on the field. Dre Ellis came in, tip your cap to the freshman, came in and got the touchdown that they needed. Now they go Padani once again as he's back in after getting bumped around there in that last drive.
Glove on the left hand this time. Looks he was not wearing that before.
We'll keep an eye. Padani's going to be back to pass. Pressure's coming, going over the middle. It's caught. A little bit of room to run as they get across the 35 to the 34. That one's Carson Bann. And Carson Bann will set up second and short as you get a look at Jeff Berkeley, one of the defensive coaches trying to explain what's happening inside that huddle. Okay, nice, we're picking this up. This is great. I don't know if they want that, but this is great. Pretty confident they don't want that, but there you go. Coach Berkeley came back last year and joined this staff and I think really added something for Coach Denneke on the defensive side. Good throw over the middle. It's caught. Eli Paulson inside the five, trying to push the Bears to the goal line. Can't quite do it, but down to the four. and that was a dime from Peyton Padani.
And that's exactly what you want to see if you're trying to get back into this game. You're running, you know, 10 minutes left in the second quarter here.
They're going to go real quick. No huddle.
Here?
No huddle. Hand off Mossman. Straight ahead. Run. Inside. Touchdown, Anoka. A lightning drive for the Tornadoes.
16 is off for one play. 16 White off for one play.
And they're pick up the ref's mic there. Thank you very much, by the way, for our referees, Tim Litvin, and the referee staff wearing the microphones tonight for us so that we can pick that up. They are going to line up and go for two here. Coach Bo's aggressive, likes going for two often whenever he gets a chance. Going to do it here. Going to go Mossman, who's got room, and he's got it. Two-point conversion for the Tornadoes, and we're back to a one-score game just like that.
Well, that's what we were talking about with the danger of this kind of offense that Anoka runs, that they can score quickly. It's the other side of that coin. They can get off the field quickly if it's not going well, but they can get right on you if it is going well, if they're connecting their throws.
I also think Anoka's won the special teams game.
Absolutely.
They've gotten a couple kickoff returns. They forced a bad punt. And when they have kicked the ball, they've generally pinned White Bear Lake deeper. And it's made a huge difference in this game, right, as they've started to come back here.
Absolutely. Fantastic stuff right there from this Tornado special teams. And you talked about that in pregame with Coach Tony Bazal. And the special teams battle right now is a big piece for the Tornadoes to get back into this game.
It's special teams on the plays themselves, but the field position's been huge. You've seen Anoka starting on their 40-yard line, on the 40-yard line of White Bear Lake, starting at or near midfield almost every drive so far. And the first couple obviously ended in disaster, but you get back into this game by playing those little things well, and then this thing you start to connect on the plays that you need to connect on to score in the end zone here.
Passing game's been pretty sharp. Both Padani and Ellis, doesn't matter who's throwing it, they're starting to make some completions in the passing game and getting some big gains.
Yeah, and even in the first drive where they didn't hit any of them, they definitely had some opportunities, so they've schemed up some good stuff. They're getting receivers open, and we're going to be in for one heck of a game here.
Yeah, it's looking good. 9:47 left to play in the first half, in a first half that is taking an ice age to complete, but it's moving slowly, but at least it's very entertaining so far. 9:47 to go. And Kwame back to kick it away again for the Tornadoes. Stalks up on the ball and then sends a booming kick deep into the end zone, and that's a touchback. Wow.
Goodness gracious, that's a leg.
There you go. Excuse me, back to work of the White Bear Lake Bears. And there's an example of the special teams, right? Because White Bear Lake's kickoffs have given Anoka good field position, not so much on the other side now.
And here again, you've got a re-energized defense. You had a big stop last time. It led to a touchdown, and you've got that confidence going here. Can we do it again?
So I would expect to see more wing T look now out of White Bear Lake again, right? They had success early with it, and then they started getting away from it. So I think they'll come back to it here.
So they do line up with a little bit more of that wing T, that tight formation. They're going to go to Lipscomb again, and why not? That was very effective in the first quarter, and he's going to run for 9.5 yards on first down. And set up second and short. You're right, they went away from that. I thought that was very interesting.
You wonder if you'll see that Anoka adjust again back to that 4-2-5 look that you were talking about before and see if maybe they can stop this and force them back into that
another tornado
spread
down
look.
Goodness gracious, another tornado down here. That's Carson Lewis.
God.
And that's,
I think maybe he got hit in a tender spot there.
Could very well be. We certainly... We wouldn't speculate at this point. No, I certainly wouldn't. But hopefully another injury. Where the good news, at least for some of the Anoka players tonight, is that they have been banged up, but they've been able to get back in there. So that's, and hopefully it stays that way, where we don't have anything really serious tonight. Because this team has had its fair share, losing Frecking early in the season. They lose Tyrell Cummings, who last year was such a speed guy for them. They really looked at him as a big running back speed option, a guy who could catch passes. Did not have him. I think it hurts this team a little bit because that's a big speed component that they were really looking forward to having. He's out with an ACL.
Well, you have an offense like Anoka likes to run. You're going to rely on speed a lot. And if you're starting to lose those guys, you need to kind of adjust your game a little bit. Now, tonight it hasn't looked like they've lost any kind of step, which is nice. But injuries start to pile up, especially on a defense that's having some trouble stopping the run. So you hope that they can stay healthy.
Yeah, we'll take a look at that and see if that situation changes.
Yeah, looks like he's walking off okay.
Yep. Anoka in the gray tonight. You know, they like to wear the, they've worn the traditional kind of the black jerseys on the Pumpkin Bowl. They had some new ones made a few years back, but apparently there's not enough. So they're wearing the nice grays, which I really like tonight with the white helmets. Handoff Lipscomb on the short, second and one, and another burst for Keyshawn Lipscomb.
Boy, that kid's got some power.
And he's, yeah, it's just kind of a bowling ball, right? Not a big kid, but fast, a very quick first step, and another first down for White Bear Lake on the ground.
Just kind of see, he got tackled there, just kind of seemed to hang in the air as, you know, that power just kind of moved through the guy tackling him. Just a hard spot to be in as a defender, especially once you get to that third level, you got those little guys back there. I shouldn't say little guys, those smaller guys back there.
First down and 10. They stay bunched. They go again with Lipscomb, who's able to get through that first line, but that time brought down. Good job by the defense from the Anoka Tornadoes as they were able to step up and make a play. 53, first one to get to him. That was Avery Fields. And Fields brings him down. 8 minutes and 35 seconds. The contrast in styles truly exists because you have White Bear Lake now, who wants a long, time-consuming drive here if they can get one.
Just look at that size that White Bear has along the offensive line. They're just a huge team up front.
A lot more seniors on this group than there are in the Tornadoes. Lipscomb again tried to turn the corner, bounced off a tackle, and it's going to set up third down and three. And actually, different back that time gets the call. They go to Cole Sather, number 26, in for Lipscomb, spelling him on that play. So Sather gets the carry that time.
Kind of third and manageable here if you were, you know, you're down 7 points with 7:59 left in the half. What are you going to here, Zach?
Well, I mean, it's a huge play for the defense, right? So I think you got to get up, and I would dare them to throw the ball out of this. They haven't had a lot of success throwing it out of the wing tee look, so I would try to make them throw it.
So they do try to bring a little heat here. They go with Lipscomb, and he's going to be stuffed at the line of scrimmage and dropped backwards, and a big stop that time for the Tornado defense, and it's going to put White Bear Lake to a decision this time. In on the stop looked like it might have been Pete Ganda, 95. Let's take another look and see.
White Bear looks like they are going
to punt. 99, Javen Starks.
Another opportunity for this Anoka special teams unit to come up big.
Yeah, great job by Starks coming down the line of scrimmage. He didn't get too far upfield. He closed down really well on it.
Trying to get a guy off the field quickly here for the Tornadoes. They do. They've got two guys back to receive here. It looks like it might be Paulson, but also, oh, big problem with the snap, but they've got room to run. Can they get the first down? It's a foot race to the corner. White Bear Lake's going to make something out of it. Oh, man, it was almost like a design play, but it wasn't, but it worked.
That's just a tough one. You're playing for the punt there, and it hitches your rhythm just a little bit, and he's able to make something of it there. It's just a tough position for the special teams unit.
That's a tough one.
Now I would look for White Bear Lake to take a shot deep here.
Interesting.
Right? When something like that happens at midfield, offenses tend to like to take a shot.
So they come back on the field after the muff punt still goes for a running first down. Just a wild first half here at Goodrich tonight. They're back to the wing tee. They hand it off. There's some room to the outside. Can they get through? Yep, near first down territory once again. As this one is Henry Wilkoxon. Wilkoxon, try to say that five times. Henry Wilkoxon, yeah, no kidding. Let me go back and get a drink of my coffee here and rethink that one. Yeah, thanks a lot. We'll work on that. First down and 10, and White Bear does pick it up.
Talk about the sand wedge. That was a sand wedge vocally there. That's all right. We'll clean that up.
You know, listen. You're allowed to make mistakes up here when you're the broadcast. When you know what? You've been doing this. I mean, what am I, Jim Erickson?
And I'm not allowed to give you a rib here. You make fun of my sandwich game.
Well, that's easy enough. Handoff again inside. This one is Keyshawn Lipscomb, and he'll get across the 30 to the 29-yard line. And boy, what a break for White Bear Lake there to keep this drive going. Huge momentum turn potentially for the Bears right after it looked like the Tornadoes were snatching some momentum right back.
And you got to stay focused on defense here. Don't let it get you down too much. Those kinds of things happen. Just come out and play your game. Do what you did for the last six plays and see if you can stop them.
Defense maybe a little flat-footed after that stop. Got to get back in tune here. Knutson, once again, they bring a man, and they'll give it to him. And it's going to be Currier, who's going to be bottled up and brought backwards that time.
Starting to see Anoka attack the ball a little bit. Starting to wonder if they're seeing the ball get held a little loose and they want to cause a fumble here. Obviously, you want to try and get that.
That's Carter Nabosny, 54, with a nice wrap there.
Obviously, you want to try and get the ball back all times on defense, but you know, after a big play like that, trying to create another momentum swing for your team is always something you're trying to do as a defender.
Critical third down. Here we are again. Third and about five, long five, maybe a short six, whatever you want to call that. Still in the wing tee. Hand it off Lipscomb again. Can he turn the corner? He can. He's up near the marker. He's going to get it. First down. Boy, is that kid all over the field tonight for the Bears. Fantastic stuff from Keyshawn Lipscomb as he picks up another first down for the Bears.
We saw it again that time. Just good blocking. I mean, just a well-executed blocking team for White Bears so far. They've just been getting to their spot, holding their guy down, and making sure that there's running room around them.
Down to the 24-yard line, first down and 10 once again for White Bear Lake. Defense gets set for the Tornadoes. They'll go straight ahead. Lots of room to run this time. He'll go untouched to the goal line, and he is in. Touchdown. I think that's Lipscomb again.
It's 26.
26 gets the carry that time. Cole Sather on a straight ahead run for basically not touched till he gets to the 1 yard line. Touchdown, White Bear Lake.
Well, the D line got upfield a little bit on that one. You see a kick out block there, and he's up the middle. And like you said, almost in the end zone before he's touched.
Cole Sather is about the same size as Lipscomb, and they wear a similar number. It's hard to catch them. Extra point down, and it is good. 28-14 now is your score.
Enough time here for Anoka to kind of try and put a drive together, make this a one-score game before halftime. And if you can get down there and score, you know, you get the ball back at the half, so you have an opportunity here to close this game still. No need to overextend or feel like you have to play any hero ball at this point in the game. It's still early. You got another half to play. And like I said, you're getting the ball back after halftime, so there's really no reason to get way too aggressive. But you want to be able to push.
Most important stuff here, time for a little weather update. We'll get you traffic at the top of the hour as well here. Temperature 45 degrees at the moment. Not much wind and a little cloudy, but this is football weather. I think we could live with this in
balmy.
October.
Balmy.
It's a balm. Yeah, you're sweating up here. Are you okay?
No, I'm thinking about losing the fleece.
Yeah, it's good.
It's not raining.
That's good.
There's been a lot of rain this year on Friday nights.
Zach's the happiest guy in the booth right now.
Yeah. Have you thought about calling plays in the booth on these rainy nights? Do you like that?
It rained last night during our game very briefly.
Yeah.
Oh. And now it's like the third one in a row for us.
There's a low line drive heading towards Paulson, who will pick it up at the 9 yard line, trying to make a move at the 10 to the 15. Got room to the 20. Got room to the 25 to the 30. Out to midfield. He's moving down the sideline to the 30 to the 28 yard line. Eli Paulson once again for the Tornadoes, giving Anoka great field position on special teams.
White Bear Lake is going to continue to get burned on these kickoffs if they can't hold their lanes. You saw that again. Both those players came in and they lost their contain. They didn't play it well. He was able to juke them both. They were unblocked. That should never have happened, and it only happened because they didn't play disciplined football.
Yep, and then Anoka sets up the wall to their sideline really well.
Special teams are the difference again.
Well, I'll tell you what, if Anoka can punch a score here in before halftime, 28-21 as you mentioned, Ryan, boy, that would change things heading into the halftime. You'd have to feel like if you're Anoka, boy, that could have been the most apocalyptic start you could have had, but that still very much in it. Padani, they're bringing pressure, and they hand it off to Mossman just as the pressure's coming in, and Coach Bo's not happy. I think it must have been a perfectly timed snap, but boy, that was very, very close.
Guard got blown up on the right side there. I'm not sure who that player was on the right guard there for Anoka. It looked like Tate Narr just got blown up on that play.
They'll hand it again. It's Mossman, straight ahead run. We'll take it to about the 28-yard line, get back to maybe the original line of scrimmage. It's going to set up third down and 10. And for Bo, this is four down territory, you have to think. For the Tornadoes, they're not going to be punting or kicking field goals. Maybe they will. They've got a kicker with a leg. Like we know that with Sam Kwame. He can kick it.
He can kick it. You'd like to get a touchdown here, but I think any points on the board in this situation, knowing you're getting the ball coming out of halftime, that's probably where you want to be. So you play this aggressive. Maybe you try it on fourth down if you get it fourth and manageable, but you don't have to push yourself too hard here.
They look back. They're bringing pressure again. Every time Padani looks back, they bring heat, but Padani's going to roll out. He's got room. Down to about the 21-yard line. That's going to be very close, maybe 2 yards or a yard and a half shy of a first down. That time they saw the pressure coming, and Peyton Padani made a good play.
And Coach Wasserick is not flinching. It looks like they're going for this.
Yeah, no question about that.
He didn't even look behind him for the field goal.
Coach calling plays on the sidelines, as he does.
This seems like maybe a good time to freeze and see if you can draw him offside too, right?
Absolutely.
The way they've been timing up those blitzes.
They're playing aggressive. You might be able to give them a little taste of their own medicine, what they did down on this end for Anoka.
Might be time to think about a cadence change, too, maybe, for the Tornadoes. Padani looking for a quick out, but instead going with a slant over the middle, and that is incomplete. Had him there, just missed it, not able to hang on that time was Avi Abekwe, and they will turn it over on downs. They had the look they wanted right here. This isn't a bad throw, just a little low.
Little low, kind of a tough break there. You'd like to see him attack that ball a little bit, knowing he has the cushion between him and the first down stripe, but that's an experience thing. It's just going to take some time for him to learn.
The D lineman may have gotten a hand on that ball, too. It looked like it just barely got tipped, but it took enough off of it.
Just a tough break, but again, you're not out of this game. You know, you can force a punt here, have an opportunity to do it again. Your special teams have been good, but you've got to play good, disciplined football, and it looks like they're playing out of the shotgun again.
That's a tough one because you don't want to give up a score here before the half, and just as we say that, Rayshon Brakes got room to the outside, and he's got all the room in the world. Can he get to the end? 30, 20, and knocked out of bounds at about the 15-yard line. Huge play from White Bear Lake as Rayshon Brakes has only touched the ball about four times, but every time he touches it, big things seem to happen.
I see the replay here, but I kind of wonder if they missed a block in the back out here.
It's the same counter play that we saw before.
Wow. Yeah, you're right. They only have ran that a few times, but it just seems like they're not ready when Brakes touches it on that outside run.
Well, it's a good job by Sawyer Chell to get down there and make a tackle, right? Force White Bear Lake to line up again because you never know what's going to happen.
Second down now. First down, I should say, 2 minutes and 40 seconds. I was looking at the two on the clock. That's what happens when you're old. A handoff straight ahead run again, looking for room and plenty of it. Touchdown untouched. That's Keyshawn Lipscomb. And he continues to be a factor, and that's a big score for White Bear Lake. What a turn of events from the muffed punt at 21-14. Now we look up, it's 34-14. After that muffed punt, a quick score from White Bear, a quick three and out for a four and out for Anoka, and then a quick two-play drive for White Bear Lake on the other side to get it all the way down. And a defensive adjustment certainly needed here. Extra point coming, and it is good.
Yeah, I think if you're Anoka here, I'd hesitate to call it worst-case scenario, but it's kind of hard to think of one that could be worse than this right now. That's right before the half, giving up that kind of drive right after you go four and out. That's a killer for a young team that's just looking for confidence, felt like they had it, and, you know, the bad snap on the punt really feels like that turning point there where the momentum just kind of shifted for White Bear Lake again.
I think we're kind of in a similar spot to where we were 2 minutes ago, though. Now your offense is back on the field. You're looking for any kind of points before the half.
Yep.
And then you come back out and build on that in the second half when you get the ball back. So, you know, an important 2 minutes and 30 seconds here for
absolutely.
Anoka.
Stay calm and execute.
That is the thing, right? This offense can score quickly. It is a quick strike offense. So you got to feel like 2.5 minutes. You got plenty of time. You got a couple timeouts. Getting score here, though, before the break, very important.
Probably. Absolutely. Absolutely. Even if, I mean, you don't want to settle for a field goal, but even if you can get 3 points, it's going to be important to get something on the board before you go in for halftime. But you really just want to make sure that you're not handing the ball back to them again.
Certainly not. Kickoff coming. White Bear Lake up 35-14. That kick is not deep. It'll be taken at about the 15-yard line. Can they set up the wall one more time? A little turn up the middle through the wedge. Some room, but up to the 30 to the 32, maybe the 33-yard line. As that's Paulson once again looking for an avenue and giving them an opportunity to set up in decent field position here.
Paulson doing a great job tonight. Would like to see him maybe, you know, move with his blockers a little bit better than he has to this point. You know, it felt like he was trying to do a little bit too much in that. He keeps following the wall. Maybe he gets a few more yards, but you know, good looking for a big play there for a team that feels like it needs it.
So Peyton Padani, they spread it out, four wide receivers. Mossman looks in the backfield with Padani. They bring pressure again straight up the middle. Padani on a quick out, they get it. Complete, it's Eli Paulson. Makes a little move, and he's got some room across midfield to the 40, down to the 39-yard line. Boy, the wiggle from Eli Paulson. That first step was fantastic and a big first down for the Tornadoes.
And a good job of getting out of bounds and saving time on the clock, too.
Yeah, that's about the third or fourth guy that he's collected his jockstrap out here. That's a really difficult guy to tackle out there. That's just freezes him and moves on.
Ryan leaves no room for the imagination.
You can find
doesn't
that
it?
Out in the stands, man.
Room for the imagination from Ryan Nelson.
Guy left his ankles out there on the 42.
My goodness. Padani, back to pass out of the shotgun. He'll look. He'll throw. He's caught and complete to the 30, to the 29-yard line. First down once again. Trey Borchers, who caught the touchdown, will get that one, and we'll move the sticks again for the Tornadoes.
Man, Padani's just dealing right now. Some really good throws from him so far in this first half.
Very impressed with his just kind of his poise in the pocket as a sophomore quarterback. Not too bad.
His strength, too. He's got a lot of zip on these balls.
Now he's going to roll out this time. He'll stop and throw over the top. Got a guy open, and it is caught. Eli Paulson, touchdown Tornadoes.
I really like the scheme on that one. He rolled out to his left, and he was able to get there, plant the foot, come back across the field to the post in the middle of the field. And that's a difficult route to cover. And a lot of times in high school, you're telling guys, like, that's the one we don't want to worry about because guys can't make that throw, but that's a really good throw by the quarterback.
I'm impressed so far. I mean, this is... If you're looking for a young quarterback and what you want to see out of a young quarterback, he's shown you so far some resolve after the mishap on the first play there.
Oh, boy. Some gadgetry to the end. No, they're not going to get the two-point conversion with that one. Trying to mix it up. And, you know, Coach Bo will do this, right? We've seen this many, many times watching Anoka football. There's the throw by Padani, and that is just another great throw. But a great catch by Paulson to stay with that one as well.
I'm just really impressed by that throw. He really didn't even set his feet very much. Just kind of... off the 1 foot and let her fly. That's impressive.
But you got the hips flipped, yep. Which is the key on that.
You see that a lot. I mean, if you're watching professional football, you watch that a lot from guys like Patrick Mahomes, too. That's too much higher degree.
But. See, Coach Bo loves these two-point conversions. This time they tried a little wide receiver pass that time and just didn't fool anybody. But they'll do these types of things, mix it up, show different looks, different coverages. They don't like to do anything very conventionally at the goal line.
Well, and once you put that stuff on film, then teams have to prepare for it. And so that takes time out of your practice each day to talk about two-point conversions and swinging gates and things like that. So just the advantage it creates in that is a huge deal.
Yeah. Like, as a defensive coordinator, when you see stuff like that on film, how long do you have to kind of think about that in a practice? Do you spend an hour? Do you spend a half hour? I mean...
You know, we tend to break stuff up throughout the week, but you might spend 10 to 15 minutes on it a couple times a week. And especially on Thursdays, right, the day before the game, you spend time on things like that.
So they get that big score. Problem is, there's still time. That was the quick strike offense. And there's still a minute 54. They're going to kick this deep. And that is way deep. That's a touchback once again. They're going to at least try to force White Bear Lake to go the distance. And now, obviously, if you're defensive coordinator Adam Denneke and the defensive coaching staff for Anoka, everything's got to be about just, hey, how do we get this thing to halftime? No more scores. Let's try to limit the big plays. Right now, the big plays just killing them on offense.
Yeah, we'll see how aggressive White Bear is, right? Will they be content up 15 going into half, knowing that they're kicking off again? Or will they try to push the ball here and score again?
Yeah, you're talking to the head coach before the game. You know, Coach Bartlett really felt like it was a game of aggression for him tonight. He wants to stay aggressive and stay on this team. So we'll see what he decides to do.
Handoff on first down. Rayshon breaks. Can he turn the corner this time? He does, but not quite as he's wrapped up. Good pursuit and a big tackle right there. As it looked like Sham Kwame came up and made the play. Also, it looked like number 24 in on the stop, Wyatt Rothram, the young sophomore. We've been saying that a lot tonight. Young sophomore for this Tornado team coming up and making plays.
And they're making plays all over the field tonight on defense. I mean, they've had a couple of big plays that they've given up, but for a young team, they've looked pretty good.
Well, they had that chance. But we go back to that muff punt, and that's going to be the big play of the half, I think. Handoff again. This time they do prepare for it. and they knock down Keyshawn Lipscomb, and that's going to keep the clock running. We get a timeout taken here. I wonder who's taking it. Anoka's going to take the timeout.
Timeout, Anoka. Anoka, timeout.
That microphone works, Mr. Litvin.
This is the interesting strategy piece of it here, right? White Bear wasted no time in the huddle. They snapped the ball with 20 seconds on the play clock still. Anoka gets a tackle for a short gain, right, and forces third and long, so now they're able to use one of their timeouts, and they still have a timeout here, right? So if they get a stop, they can call a timeout and get the offense back on the field. So interesting decision there by White Bear Lake, maybe to press the situation where if they had been more content and let more time run, we might be headed to halftime.
Current standings in the Metro Maroon North. Again, that Forest Lake team, we talked about this a little earlier. What a season they've had after just so many years of struggling. To be 5-0, that Stillwater team that just beat this White Bear Lake team last week, 5-0, White Bear 3-2, Osseo 2-3, and then Anoka, Moundsview, and Roseville making up the bottom of this Metro Maroon. Anything interesting stick out here for you, Zach?
Well, aside from the COVID year where we, you know, had a limited number of games, this is Forest Lake's first winning season since, I believe, 2001. So that's a long time and a great start right there, 5-0.
Third down and about seven. Anoka looking to maybe force a punt here. Handoff, Rayshon breaks to the outside. Pursuit there. Now he's going to try to double back. Can he get around the defense? No, he can't. He is bottled up. Coach Bo quickly yells for a timeout and gets it with a minute 11 to go. In this first half, Coach Bo wants the ball one more time.
Yeah, this is, again, kind of a game management thing with White Bear Lake. Kind of. They're playing a dangerous game here with an offense that has clearly shown they can get behind you with their receivers and get the ball to them. It feels like a potential for a disaster here before the half.
And White Bear's punt team has struggled tonight.
Yep.
We've had the bad snap. We had the punt that went sideways for about 5 yards.
And we've had penalties.
Yeah, so this could be a big swing here again, right? In a half full of swings.
Yeah, it has been a wild first half here at Goodrich. And now the punter is going to have to sit probably on his own 10, roughly, for this one. Maybe there's going to be good field position and a potential for a return for Eli Paulson, depending on how good this punt is.
When Anoka's gotten close to blocking a couple of these, they were really close on the one that got dropped.
Well, we just had the muff punt. Yeah, I mean, who knows what can happen here? Oh, boy.
Let's see if they can get this off clean.
Good stuff. As White Bear Lake gets the punt clean, they will get it off. It's not a deep punt. It's a short one. And it's hit.
So now
it's a live ball, and they will down it. Wow. But now they hit him, but they want something here. Yeah, they want it at the spot where it was touched, and there it is. That's the call. The referee's coming in and saying, nope, put that on the 47-yard line for White Bear Lake.
So once the ball hits the return, or the
first touching,
the kicking
first touching.
Team, the ball can be picked up and returned, and whatever happens, worst case scenario, you can put it back where they first touched it. So if Anoka had gotten to that ball and picked it up and ran, they could have returned it and then taken the better of the two options. But unfortunately, they weren't able to get to it there before White Bear Lake downed it again. But they still get the ball in plus territory.
Plus territory with a minute 11 to go. No timeouts, but you do obviously a clock gets stopped on every first down. And we know Bo likes to move very quickly when he has the opportunity after a first down, so they don't huddle. So there's no pressure here. They're going to roll out Padani on first down. Pressure coming. They throw it complete. And referee gets absolutely blown up on the sideline. That was caught. Is it a good catch? I think it is. What's the call here? They say incomplete.
Yeah, that looks incomplete to me.
So they say incomplete right there as they tried to work that to the sidelines. Could not tell. Second down and 10. And that referee will feel that in the morning. If he's not feeling it now. 45-degree night. That's not the shot you want to take at the legs there. Minute 5 to go. And clock stopped after the incomplete pass. Padani. Shotgun.
So space for Paulson here. Playing off of him.
Back to pass, going outside with it. It's caught, some room to the outside once again to the 35-yard line and out of bounds, pass caught by Carson Band.
I continue to be impressed by the discipline of these Anoka ball carriers to get out of bounds in this scenario. It feels like every time they've got the ball in space, they're looking for the sideline without a timeout.
So they will go third down and looks like a yard short. It's very close, yeah, about a yard short, third and one. They did get out of bounds, so there's 58 seconds to play first half in a 35-20 game. Just a wild one so far at Goodrich that's seen just about everything.
And Wiper Lake here with one down lineman. And a second one really wide.
Interesting to see here. Padani back to pass. He's going to run straight ahead through it. Got a first down and more. Padani will slide at the 30-yard line. First down. Clock stop. Coach Bo says he was hit after the slide. There should be a call. Doesn't get it. Coach will be all about talking. He's maybe not the biggest fan of the officials at this moment. They're going to get down, though, as the clock has finally started again after it was reset. First down and 10. Clock moving 45 seconds. Padani back to pass. He's going to look. He's going to throw. It's caught by Paulson. Can Paulson stay in bounds? He is out of bounds, it looks like, and that will go for not much of a gain, maybe a yard to the 31-yard line.
Well, it's better than the alternative. It was kind of under pressure there on that throw. Just get the ball out of your hands and see if your playmaker can do something with it. Yeah, ooh. That's probably not much there, but you get contact to the head after a slide. That's, I don't know what the letter of the rule is for the State High School League, but
40 seconds. Padani, who's been under siege but has played really well here in this second quarter, he's up top and throwing. He's got a guy down there and just can't complete it. Trey Borchers had a step but not able to haul it in.
Yeah, that's one that Borchers on film this week is going to go back and look at and say that he needs to keep running there, because if he just stays with it, he's probably got a touchdown catch. Kind of slows up at the end there, looking for the ball.
Maybe a little contact, perhaps?
Yeah, it looked like there was a little bit there. Maybe the feet got tangled up just enough to slow him down.
You call that good defense in the game, right?
Yeah. I wouldn't expect a call.
No, absolutely.
On that. No.
Good coverage entirely there. So 35 seconds to go. It's third down and 9. Still time to move this thing wherever they want. Padani's going to go back to pass. He rolls one step now. He stops, throws, plants, throws it over the top into nobody. Big coverage there for White Bear Lake. They had three white shirts all over that one. And that looked like maybe a situation, Zach, where he was going to throw that ball that direction no matter what happened. That was the first read right there.
He might have had the look that he wanted. And, now we have a fourth and long, and you're up against the clock.
So you got to get the first down here. You need 9 yards. Whole field's in play. The clock does stop on a first down.
Kind of got a lot of space in the middle. I wonder if they go back to that quarterback draw again.
Anoka's an empty here.
So they've got 5 wide receivers through the Tornadoes. Empty formation, Padani. He's got pressure coming. He's going to run to the outside. He's going to throw it, and that might be a big collision there on Paulson as he gets thrown to the ground. That may not have been a catchable ball, but either way, he didn't have a chance to go get that one.
Yeah, that's one that you might get some fans in the stands complaining about, but I don't think that that was catchable. It was just a little too high for Mr. Paulson there. Now you just kind of got to get out of the half and don't give up a big play here.
So to the sidelines go the offense for the Tornadoes as they come up empty at the end of the half. But 25 seconds to go. We might finally bring an end to this half that I swear started last night. And here we are, almost ready to conclude it. An hour and 20-minute first half. There's some games that end around this time. Handoff Lipscomb. Can he get a big play before the half? Oh, big stop right there. Hanging on for dear life with Zach Welch.
Timeout on the field. Timeout, White Bear Lake.
White Bear Lake will actually take a timeout here. They've got, they can't take them with you, so you might as well burn them here. But 15 seconds to go on the big play.
I think they're going to put a little time back on the clock here. I was expecting White Bear Lake to come out and run fullback dive and head to half, and instead they're in spread, and they're going to take their shots.
Kind of got to hope that you don't have any major mishaps running that. You got to spread around the field, and Anoka's been able to get by you a little bit here. They've been able to beat your offensive line in these passing situations and get a little bit of pressure on your quarterback. Throws have not looked very good. So you kind of got to pray that there's no turnovers or strip sacks or anything behind the line there, because that could turn into disaster for White Bear Lake. But, just hit your spot, make the throw, and play good football.
I think White Bear Lake might be content to hand the ball off here a couple times and take their time out and then run it again, because they have shown the ability to crack a big one.
Sure, absolutely. I mean, it's those reverses, if you can get breaks out there again and in open space, he's been deadly out there tonight.
So Gavin Knutson has not had to throw a ton here or anything tonight like they did last week. But he's there in the spread formation once again. And he will throw. Caught. Complete there. Can they make some room and stay in bounds? They're going to get out of bounds right there as pass is caught
clock,
and completed.
Clock.
Yep, the clock is running there because he went backwards out of bounds.
Going to force him to take another timeout, I think.
So they do take the timeout. Second timeout taken here from White Bear Lake as Delaney makes the catch for the Bears, setting up a first down as they did get it. The Magnum PI music playing now overhead. I got to tell you, it really brings everything back. When I think football, I think Tom Selleck and chest hair and Hawaiian shirts.
I almost wore a Hawaiian shirt tonight, Tim.
I'm kind of glad you went with the fleece instead, I must admit.
The thought crossed the mind. I got to let you know.
Well, we should talk about that and have a theme next time they let us all three get in the booth together.
Are we sure they're going to let us do it again?
That's a great question. We don't really know the answer to that. But next time, we must make sure we have matching outfits. Let's please make sure we do that.
Next time we're out here for the Pumpkin Bowl, we might as well just dress up in costume.
Might as well. You just may have hit on it right there. Close circuit to Taylor. Costume event next year for QCTV and the Pumpkin Bowl.
I thought you were in your lumberjack costume already, so.
The plaid, I know makes that confusing for you.
And the beard.
There you go.
Only missing a little axe.
Boy, they step back here in a full prevent here, the Tornadoes. Just not trying to give up a big play here before the half. Moving guys backward. Three down linemen. They go to Lipscomb, who's got room. Can he get through the defensive? Anoka can get up near the first down. That'll stop the clock at least to set that. And will they use their last timeout? It looks like they will. Last timeout for White Bear Lake.
Third and final charge timeout of the first half.
So Ryan Bartlett conceding nothing here, which is interesting stuff from both these coaches, being very aggressive and not being afraid to play their game all the way to the end.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know, Zach can correct me if I'm wrong here, but I think if you're White Bear, you got to take a shot here. 5 seconds left, just kind of drop back and throw it up and see if you can get something in the end zone here. Either a flag or a catch.
Yeah, you got to think you're not passing here, or not running here, right? If you're Anoka, you wouldn't plan for that.
No, if it's a run, it's going to be something like a reverse or a trick play, right? I think you're going to see him throw the ball deep, or maybe you'll see a hook and ladder.
I was just about to say hook and ladder. Get to about that 35-yard line with the crossing routes and just kind of toss it back to the under guy.
I still have nightmares.
And that's the conversation certainly being had by those defensive coaches on the sidelines. Certainly Adam Denneke in the booth radioing that down and saying, hey, let's be aware of all of these possibilities.
Well, they're playing off. They clearly know that they're going to try and take some kind of shot here.
Maybe Vitell Henderson. That's been their big target wide receiver. They might look to him on the far side. Knutson back to pass. He's going to roll out, and he's heaving. He's going for it all to the end zone. It's going to come up short, knocked down. And that will do it for the first half here at Goodrich Field. And what a first half it was. We need a break just for our own selves here at QCTV. For Ryan and Zach, we'll be back to talk the second half soon. But first, enjoy At the Half on QCTV.
Welcome to At the Half, the show where we take a closer look at some of our area high school sports. I'm your host, Lauren Youngquist. The Huskies look to capitalize on their team's overall experience and progress of their success in recent years. Let's head out to Andover High School to check in with the team.
We have great kids, and so that's a consistency from year to year. This year on our girls' side, we have a very large contingent of seniors. And so we have a great leadership group and kids that have worked very hard and they're going to be successful. So that makes it fun as a coach when you have a team that's going to be competitive and kids that have really bought in and work hard and enjoy that process of getting better. Our boys' side, we lost a couple of great runners and leaders. But we're a pretty deep team, and we feel we're going to be probably even more competitive than we were last year.
We lost one senior last year, however, she was injured for most of the year, so we're not losing much on that aspect. We do have a lot of new people coming in, which is very good to see just because it helps us build numbers and that helps us train more. But I think we're looking pretty good this year, and it's basically the same as last year.
Yeah, definitely having not losing a lot of seniors help because we're kind of just going into the next season with the same team dynamic, yeah. But we're all training better now.
Like sometimes you base yourself off of other people on your team, but it's kind of just go out and do your best.
Yeah, and it's you're out there for the whole time, as in like other sports, you have time for breaks and to think about stuff, but when you're running, there's no time to stop and think about what you're doing, you just have to keep going.
Also, a lot of people coming in have said that the support on the team is incredible, whether it's coming from racing to workouts, just the support we have and how we're like a family, I think really sets us apart from other sports.
Yeah, the team aspect and the individual part is definitely something that makes it unique. Going out there and you're trying to beat yourself every time, it's different than a lot of other sports. And also, while you're out there, it's not only about you, it's just you're racing for your team and trying to better yourself.
Also, one of those things that everybody knows is healthy for you. And so you're learning an athletic event that is going to benefit you for years to come. And so I think there's some satisfaction in that as well. They know they're going to be able to run when they get older. They know that they're going to know what to do properly. And so all of those kind of feed into being unique and a lifelong sport.
We sat down with Macy and Grace from the Anoka Tornadoes tennis team to get a unique perspective on the team's personality. Let's head out on the court to learn more.
What could you not live without? Cheese? I don't know. It could be cheese, knowing you. Okay, your dogs. Do you have dogs?
I do.
Oh, okay.
I have two dogs.
Two dogs. Family. It could be family. I don't know. This is a hard one. Sushi? I feel like you said you don't like sushi. I'm gonna say cheese.
The answer was family, but that was a close second, actually.
Okay. So.
Who on the team has the most screen time?
Said Aaliyah, and that could be a possibility because it's Aaliyah.
Yeah.
She's always on TikTok. But it also could be Hayes because he's old. So yeah.
Watching the tennis surf.
He loves, yeah.
Over and over.
Oh my God. I don't see you put Aurora. I don't think it's Aurora because I don't think she's on her phone that much.
Yeah.
And I don't think it's Kaylin because even though she's on her phone, I don't think it's as much as my final answer is Aaliyah.
It was Aaliyah.
Oh, shit.
Okay. You got it. Who is most likely to record a TikTok dance? Aaliyah? Well, she just did that at the other match we had, so it's very possibly her. Joey? No, I don't. Does Joey have TikTok?
Probably not.
Okay. Yeah, not Joey. Cammy? She could do it. She's kind of spontaneous. Hayes? No, not Hayes. I'm gonna say Aaliyah.
You're right.
Yay.
Who has the best fashion sense?
A is Hayes. And I mean, his matching red outfit is pretty fire today, but I don't think it's him. Uh-huh. B is Cammy. I'm just gonna say I don't think it's Cammy either. C is Sophie, which I think is probably the close second, but I'm gonna go with Joey as my final answer because Joey is always dripping and is
always on
clothes.
Point. Yeah. I did Sophie. That's
okay.
Who I thought.
All right. Mm-hmm.
Who takes the longest to get ready for school? Sophie? I feel like she puts a lot of effort into what she wears, so it could be her. Megan, Kay, I don't know. I feel like she tries too. Aaliyah, I don't know. There's so many out here that could be right. Or Allie. No, I don't think it's Allie. Mm-hmm. She's still in middle school. I'm gonna say Aaliyah.
My answer was Sophie.
Okay.
Close.
Who is the best table tennis player?
A is Coach Grace, which, you know, that's a possible answer because Grace is pretty good at most things she does, I think. B is Allie. I think it's not Allie because she's only 12, so she doesn't have experience.
Mm-hmm.
C
see is me, and I think it's me because I'm insane at table tennis. And D is Lexi. I don't think it's Lexi just because I think it's me.
I said Coach Grace.
Okay,
sorry.
Fair enough. Fair enough.
All right. That's close.
Cool.
The Rebels have an extensive depth on their girls' swimming team. They are excited and driven to help each other reach success. We dove in to figure out how the Rebels look to compete in their 2022 season.
Yeah, so we only had a few seniors last year. Our senior class this year is actually the largest. We came in with about 25 starting in seventh grade, 25 in our class, and I think we're down to less than that, around 15, just because of other sports, people are busy. But we still have the largest class. We do have a lot of new girls though.
This year, a lot of our team, or like a third of our team, are middle schoolers, so it's a lot of underclassmen and younger girls, so that's a lot different, but still a really strong team. We've always had a really deep team. Instead of like one star swimmer, we have a good lineup of intermediate, and it works out really well for us. We try to do as many activities as we can and lots of games to get to know each other. And then sometimes we'll do like big sister, little sister, so we'll match an upperclassman with a younger girl to walk through meets and practices and just kind of get situated with the team.
Last year we recovered a little bit. It was a transition year for everyone, getting back to pre-COVID workout habits. But this year already, you know, we're only 2.5 weeks in, and I can already tell that there is a major mental shift and more positive energy throughout this team. We seem to be more unified already, which I think sets a good example for the rest of the year to come.
Yeah, so swimming is an individual sport in general, but the way it works, you do individual races, so you race and you're racing for your own time. Certain times get you letters, certain times it gets you to go to certain competitions like sections or state. But at the same time, when you get a certain place, you score points for a team, and it's really the team points that matter at the end of the meet to see who wins, and that places you in the conference.
It is a very individual sport, but at the same time it's a team sport, which is hard for people to wrap their mind around. But that's what I like about it. You can compete as yourself and against the time. And as long as you are improving on your time, you're winning that day. You don't need to beat the person next to you. Just focus on you. That's what I tell my athletes. Focus on you. You aren't always racing the person next to you. As long as you can improve, you won that day. As a team sport, it's a lot of fun because you never know who's going to be scoring points for your team that day. Someone might have a swim of a lifetime, and it's very fun for a whole team. It's fun for the coaches to see that. It's like, where did that come from? Is there more of that in there?
That's it for this edition of At the Half. Make sure to keep up to date with all your local sports coverages by liking and subscribing to our Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube pages. Thanks for watching.
Hey, boss. Okay?
Yeah, I'm good.
You sure?
I said I'm fine.
Since I was little, it was only like me and my parents.
You think you created family out of characters?
Yeah, of course.
I'm gonna take that and make it into a song.
Hey, Bob.
You can talk to me.
It's been really, really hard for me.
Hey, Bobo. Do trees tell each other stories?
I'm sorry. I'm afraid I don't know that.
Hey, why don't we go find out? Listen.
Do clouds take naps?
I couldn't tell you.
Dad? Do stars visit their friends?
Look!
Space Rocket-themed playground is a kid favorite. It also boasts Anoka's premier skate park and has wonderful family picnic areas. For more information on any of these parks, please check out www.ci.anoka.mn.us.
Impact Services Meals on Wheels and More in Anoka County offers meals throughout all of Anoka County and Champlin. Meals on Wheels provides nutritious hot meals Monday through Friday with weekend options. Who can get Meals on Wheels? We're here for anyone who can benefit from home-delivered meals with a focus on older adults and people with disabilities. Meals on Wheels is great if you could use help cooking or need a break from doing it, you're recovering from an illness or injury, getting out to purchase food is difficult. With your tax-deductible gift to Impact Services, Meals on Wheels, every $5 donated provides a hot, nutritious meal delivered to a neighbor in need in Anoka County and Champlin. Impact Services Meals on Wheels is a volunteer-driven organization. We have meal pickup sites in Anoka, Coon Rapids, East Bethel, Lino Lakes, and Fridley. Please keep in mind that if your company offers volunteer hours, we need drivers. The commitment is as it works for your schedule. It's a great way to spend your lunch. For more information, go to www.impactservicesmn.org.
If you need to do something to feel okay to drive, you're not okay to drive. Don't drive buzzed.
Anoka County Brotherhood Council, also known as ACBC Food Shelf, is a community-based organization located in Anoka County, serving over 10,000 families per year. We have been providing our neighbors with food, clothing, and resources for over 50 years. Providing food to the community is our largest program, and we do this through a food shelf, a grocery delivery program for those who are homebound, and special food distributions available throughout the year. We value our participants' time and have appointments available online and by phone to ensure quick services, making it easier for those with tight schedules and transportation difficulties. The experience of the shopper is important to us, and we take great care in making sure our food shelf market is well stocked, especially with fresh and healthy food items, which can be more expensive for those on tight budgets. We want our space to feel like a grocery store, and we want our shoppers to feel they are cared for. When someone visits us, they will also have access to our family advocate who can provide assistance in navigation with other resources and partnerships. We also have a clothing closet which has clothing and household items for the entire family, a birthday bag program where parents can select age-appropriate theme bags for children up to age 18, and for low-income adults ages 60 plus, we are the only food shelf in Minnesota selected as a CSFP food provider, providing the opportunity for extra food items and nutrition education. We are blessed to be in such a great community that supports our work with volunteers, food donations, cash donations, and just sharing our message. We thank you for your support.
Hey, hope you had a chance to go get a snack or something, stretch out, make some popcorn, have some coffee, that kind of thing. It's a little chilly night here at Goodrich Field, 35-20 at the break. Let's take a look at a wild, wild first half between these two teams. After getting out 21-0, this second quarter was crazy. A touchdown from Mossman right there, getting it to 21-6, then a big breakout touchdown. This game was close there. It got looked like it was about to turn. There's another touchdown from Lipscomb. Padani with a big hit to Eli Paulson. The one play that we didn't really look at here, a missed, like it looked like a potentially missed opportunity on a punt for White Bear Lake, really swung the tide in this first half, no question about it.
Yep, that was the change in the game. I think it was a seven-point game, and Anoka was getting the ball back, and instead it ended up with a first down for White Bear Lake and a touchdown to pull it to 28-14.
14.
And the tone really shifted at that point, too, where you saw that Anoka really kind of got gassed on defense a little bit. They needed to get to recoup, mentally find their break again. And toward the end of the half, it seemed like they found it, but it really was a big change for them.
Mossman, Paulson back to receive as they'll start with the ball. They're going to try that little pooch thing again. Smith's going to fair catch it. He muffs it. It's a loose ball. Who's got it? Does White Bear finally have it? They do, it appears. Brennan Smith called for the fair catch, and it went right through his hands. And another just apocalyptic start for the Tornadoes.
Yeah, that's you can't have that if you're Anoka. You have not been able to stop them running the ball on defense here. To give them the ball back to start the half, it was kind of what you were counting on, was to come out on offense. You've got to catch that ball, and if you can't catch it, you got to fall on it.
And Coach Bo letting them know, like, hey, don't worry about waving your arm around here so much. Just try to make sure we get the ball. As he was a little exasperated by that. And now the defense, just after it, talking about stemming the tide here, maybe getting a little offensive going the other way, back on the heels again. It's just one step forward, two steps back for the Tornadoes tonight.
That's kind of the name of the game with young teams sometimes, is that discipline, that that small execution stuff can be a problem.
Hand off again. It's Keyshawn Lipscomb, who was super busy in the first half for White Bear Lake, had a monster start, and he was able to pick up five right there. As we get underway in the third quarter, big ups to the marching band, and good luck to them at the state marching band championships with their performance of Victory or Valhalla in honor of Ryan Nelson Kane and his inner Viking. That was a big deal right there. And also a big shout to the fall performance team, the dance team out here at halftime as well. Nice work by them, and good luck going forward. Second down and five. Handoff once again, and another breakaway there. And up near first down yardage, and they're going to get it. First down, White Bear Lake. This is where Ryan or Zach, they might need a turnover here, the Tornadoes.
Yeah, they're put in a tough spot, right? Short field, and where they took over right away, it's four down territory, right? And with this run game, it makes it difficult, because even if you're running it for 2-3 yards a pop, you're looking at a first down in four down territory. So it'll come up. They're going to need a tackle for a loss or no gain here and try to get them into a long situation.
Still lining up. Handoff. Lipscomb again, straight ahead run. That fullback dive, been working quite well. You don't see, this is a little different than some of that traditional option wing T stuff where you see some pitches to those wide backs and stuff like that. This is a lot more straight ahead running with the fullback out of this scheme.
Well, it really grinds you down, especially when your shortest runs are, you know, outside of the aberrational, you know, 2-3 yard runs. We're seeing a lot of fours and fives as their short runs, and then 7-8-9s. As their normal runs. That, I mean, that's just going to grind a defense down. You get into these manageable positions as an offense, but it's unmanageable if you're the defense.
A handoff yet again, and this time not much. And they'll be stopped for no gain. Third down and five, maybe six. Take another look.
Looks like the spell back again there.
Tackle on that play from number 53. That was Avery Fields. Fields a junior, this very young Tornado team.
Big third down here if you're Anoka. You want to keep them about this distance if you know it's going to be four down territory.
They go with a little more size in the backfield this time behind Knutson. They hand it off Sather, and he's going to lose the ball. That's on the ground. Who's got it?
Looks like White Bear got back on top.
Anoka's pointing, but White Bear's pointing as well, so it might be White Bear. Yes, it is. Wind the clock, fourth down. And that might have been the play they were looking for, but just getting back on top of it. That's the big old lineman for White Bear Lake, number 71, Joel Seifried.
Yeah, a tough run there for number 26, Cole Seether. I mean, that's just, you can't drop that ball.
Yeah, just fourth down. This is it. Big stop potentially for the Tornadoes if they can get it. They need one right here. Don't want to jump off sides. They look back. Waiting for a call from the coach. Maybe Coach Bartlett changing the play here as they peer in. Five to go on the play clock. Four to go on the play clock. They're not going to snap this thing.
Timeout on the field.
And timeout. They take a timeout.
White Bear Lake takes their first.
So they were trying to get him to jump right there the whole time.
Yeah, they went hard count, and I think they were hoping to get it down to fourth and one, or a first down, actually. It was right fourth and four there. So you might see the field goal unit come on here. It looked like they brought a few extra guys into the huddle. We'll see what the decision's made here.
Some first half stats for you. 18 first downs to two That's very interesting. Now, again, 341 on rush yards. Are you serious? My goodness. But the passing yards were big for Anoka. That's where they were able to make some hay. So 353 to 178 in the first half. Penalty yards were a big thing, but they didn't really play a factor, even though it's heavy on the White Bear Lake side. And obviously five touchdowns to three. It was a very explosive first half.
Constant swings. I mean, the momentum shifted three, four times in that first half. And we've already kind of seen a momentum shift here in the second half. And, you know, hopefully we can see a little bit more defense getting played around here in the second half. But, you know, it might be tough sled for both these defenses out here today.
Anoka defense imploring this student section to get up and get loud. And we'll see if they're huddling together for warmth, if they can muster up some noise here on the orange side of this field. Out to run this fourth down. Now, that's interesting to try to force a hard count, but then you burn a timeout in this process to do that, and you're still going to go for it on fourth down and four. Crowd's loud. Here we go. Handoff straight ahead. There's room. It's going to be close, and they're up near the marker, and I think they got it. Out to the 15-yard line. Just getting what they need to get from Keyshawn Lipscomb on the ground. White Bear Lake moves the chains yet again.
Tough spot there for the Anoka defense. You're really hoping you'll get off the field there and just can't close on that tackle soon enough. And, you know, felt like that was one of those where you got them for one of their shorter runs. But like we said, when their short runs are 3, 4, 5 yards, that's a tough spot to be in.
8 minutes, 29 seconds to go. Again, a fumble on the kickoff gives White Bear the ball to start this second half, and they're trying to cash in. Handoff. And that's more your traditional look right there, handing it off to that back coming in motion right there to take the handoff, and that works to the sidelines. They pick up 3 yards.
He's a little shook up on that play. He got hit pretty hard. Wondered if maybe he's having just a little bit of trouble breathing after that hit. He took one right to the gut there.
Rayshon Brakes, who's just made some big plays in this half without really touching the ball a ton. I mean, he's had it 5, 6 times, but I just feel like every time he touches it, there's trouble.
I feel like with all these run plays we've seen, there might be a play-action pass here in the near future.
Second down and 7. Temp feels like it's gotten a pinch cooler. I may have to close the window again. We'll see. Hand off. Oh, fumble on the ground. That ball's loose. Who's got it? Did White Bear fall back on top of it? They might have. Yes, they did.
Break after break after break for White Bear on this drive so far.
And Coach Bo has just got to feel a little snake bit here tonight, the Tornadoes. It just feels like nothing has gone their way when they've needed it. And there's another chance there, but they're not able to capitalize on the second fumble of this drive.
It looked like Knudsen didn't get it clean from under center and then was still moving around a little bit as he tried to hand it off.
Kind of tried to throw it into his gut, which is never a good sign for a running back trying to take that handoff.
Critical third down yet again. Third and 7. 7 minutes to play. Third quarter. White Bear Lake leads 35-20. Oh, whistle. False start. And that might back him up 5.
And not only does it cost them the 5 yards, but they also showed they were coming back with counter there.
5 yard penalty, third down.
So you probably can't run that now. That was what they obviously wanted to do.
Puts you into 3rd and 12, which, you know, you want, if you're going to be 4 down territory, you maybe get 6 or 7 in this, and it's acceptable. But if you can't move the ball on this down, you're putting a really tough spot at 4th and 12.
Yeah, I think that they pick up just a few yards here, they may go a field goal.
Yeah.
If they trust their kicker at all, right, you push it to a 3-score game again with a field goal.
Now, we've seen their special teams have a lot of problems, so do you really want to roll the dice on special teams again? I guess we'll find out
if they're
going to
spread
this
out. Keep your eye on Vatel Henderson, bottom of your screen. Number 14. And they'll call a timeout.
Timeout on the field.
So White Bear burning their second timeout of the half on this drive.
The first drive of the second half, they burned 2 timeouts.
Yeah, the play clock was down to 0. And
you don't want to go back 5 more because this is critical right now. Every yard is pretty crucial in this spot.
Especially when we talked earlier, the kicking game didn't look like it was exceptional, right? They might be able to hit a short one, but the further you're going back, the more riskier it's getting.
You know, for starting in plus territory, they've taken a ton of time off the clock in this first drive.
Yeah, this feels, after that really long first half, kind of what they wanted to do, right? Control the ball, eat some clock, long possessions, that kind of thing. After getting up 21-0, White Bear Lake has had to fight. It's been an interesting game after this weird swing that we saw in the first half. Now let's see if the Anoka crowd can get loud on 3rd down and 12. 3rd and 12, Knutson waits on a spread. Back to pass, here comes pressure, he is sacked! coming in to get him, number 44, Ian Wittick.
99.
Was it 99? I can't read these numbers.
Javon Starks.
Starks. Oh, it's the numbers. I blame the numbers. Look at Starks.
Good sack. Way to wrap him up, get him down. You know, sometimes those quarterbacks can be wily and stand there while they're getting hit and throw that ball. So a good way to kind of twist him and get him off his spot.
And that sack definitely takes him out of field goal range.
If you're Anoka, you got to love when you can put him in these spread downs. They've seemed to have had success defensively doing that.
Fourth and 19.
This is a big one. Anoka bringing pressure again. Starks on the outside, throwing it as Knutson. It's up in the air, and it is incomplete.
Probably happy you didn't pick that one.
Yeah, yeah. Good job of knocking it down.
Yeah. The Tornado defense gets a huge hold as we take a look at the pass again from Knutson looking for Henderson, and that was right off his hands. It looked like he had it.
You know, if that was a spear, it would have killed him. That was right in his chest.
Man.
Well, good job by the defense bowing their neck there, right? First and 10 from the 12-yard line, and they came away with no points.
Absolutely. I mean, a great defensive performance, but that's exactly what we talked about you needed, right? It's you have that break on special teams. You didn't catch that onside kick with the fair catch. Now you have an opportunity to come out and make this a one-score game.
So they weather that storm. Big momentum builder potentially for the defense for the Tornadoes. Now Peyton Padani will come back on offense for Anoka. He's back to pass on first down. He's got pressure coming. He's going to get away from the first one, and he'll slide down and pick up 2-3 yards.
It's a really smart play from a young quarterback. Keep your eyes downfield. Move up in the pocket. Keep your eyes downfield again. Recognize you've got nothing and take what the defense gives you there on 2-3 yards on first down. In that situation, that's kind of exactly what you're looking for.
Absolutely.
As I talk over Berkeley again, so he, you know, we don't get in any trouble here.
And now a big sack as Padani was back to pass, but that defense coming after him here, dialing it up on these first two plays. And that's the thing, too, when you don't really have a running game, guys, it gives the defense a pretty good opportunity to pin their ears back and come after you every down.
Yeah, I wonder if Anoka will go into some more empty looks.
Yep.
Most high school teams are limited in the ways they'll defend that. There's only one or two ways a lot of them will do it. And that might ease up some of the rush, too.
I wonder if we'll see maybe another screen or two here just to kind of maybe make them think twice about rushing.
Here they come. Full pressure again. Padani's got to run, and he's got to run hard. He'll throw it on the run, and he completes it. And it's caught by Eli Paulson. He's going to be short of the first down, but it gets them out of trouble a little bit out to the 30-yard line.
We're down two scores here with how much time they took off the clock on that first drive. Do you think about going for it here?
I think you have to kick the ball. I think it's too early, right? Especially if you don't get it here, right? You're putting yourself in a tough spot. But it looks like they're going to keep the offense on the field.
They put a helmet on Kwame, who is their punter, and you wonder if they'll make a switch here at the end. We'll see what they're looking at. Yep, they're going to make the move. So they go with they take Padani off the field, but the punter's not on the field, and I wonder if what they're going to do here. Nope, boy, what are they doing? Eli Paulson will step back, and he'll fake it, and they got to run. Eli's got to go. He'll punt it. Oh, interesting trickeration from Anoka. They'll make something happen out of this quick kick and get it down to the 44-yard line. Oh, my goodness.
Some uneasy looks shared up here at the booth
Oh, my goodness.
Well, I think the plan was for him to quick kick it much sooner, and yep. That pressure there made him hang on to it a little bit and roll out a little further than they wanted to. In the end, it works out.
Good
right?
play to get it off. I mean, that's...
Yep.
Could have been disaster.
But it's another look, right? That's not the traditional punt scheme. They're trying all kinds of different stuff there. You know, Coach Bo likes to give you lots of looks, and he's certainly doing that still. Back to work goes White Bear Lake after they get the quick three and out. Up the middle, not a whole lot there on first down. Maybe a pickup of two out to the 46-yard line. So a quick ending to that drive. As those Tornado offensive guys get some instruction on the sidelines, a slick mullet or two right down there as well.
You got to have it, Tim.
No, you got to. I mean, otherwise it's not sports, right? You must have a mullet. It's a thing. It's a thing here for sure.
Kind of interesting to watch another change here on the defensive front for Anoka here back to that 3-4 look.
Oh, so, I think we got movement there.
Yeah, I was going to say that they had two guys moving early, 5-1.
Dead ball penalty, false start on the offense. So that'll
and again, that was the counter play coming back that they've had a lot of success with. that was flagged early, and now they, right again, you probably can't go run it now on second down when they really wanted to.
It does feel like that in the, coming into the second half, we've seen some sloppiness from White Bear Lake a little bit. Obviously, they catch a break on the onside kick. But, you know, just some general sloppiness so far with the penalties and not quite able to connect on some of the bigger plays that they had in the first half. I mean, credit to the Anoka defense for making that stand, but if you're going to keep this lead, you've got to play a little cleaner.
Well, this is getting them back behind the chains, for the, which they never really played in the entire first half. Hand off again as Lipscomb gets a yard of it back, or a couple yards of it back, inside the original line of scrimmage out to the 45-yard line. Going to set up a third down and nine. They're behind the chains, though, which is stuff they just weren't behind at all in the first half.
Well, and the other thing Anoka's done is limited the big home run play. And so even if they are getting some positive yardage, they're still making them line up again. And high school offenses will have trouble, right? Somebody will move early. You'll get called for a hold. You have a fumbled exchange. Things like that happen if you can just make them line up again.
Third down and nine. Another chance for a critical stop. Anoka trying to get loud here yet again. They hand it off on the inside counter. Nice little move right there. It's Rayshon Breaks with another first down. And he will try to keep the train rolling across the 40 to the 35, down to the 33. What a run from Rayshon Breaks. And there's that play again. We saw this a few times now in this game, guys. That same little turnaround handoff counter, and it works pretty well.
Yeah, when they seem to need a big play on third down, that's what they're looking for.
Well, you talked earlier on how you stop this wing tee offense. You follow the guards, and it just doesn't seem like that's what happens on that counter play a lot. They do have a guard out there, and they're just getting sucked in on watching the play here. They're not really following the fundamentals on how to defend that play.
And Knutson does a nice job of hiding that football on that play, really trying to create some misdirection, and it seems to be working. Now they go with a more straight-ahead run with Sather. He'll pick up 4 or 5 yards as they cross the 30 to the 29 in a very quick-moving third quarter, as we're down to 2 minutes to play already in quarter number three.
Like another small injury there for Anoka, number 54. I'm trying to see who that is. That's a tough break for them.
He's been out there quite a bit.
Got up a little gimpy there, grabbing at that left hamstring.
And Nabosny's one of the veteran guys. He's a junior on this team. A lot of sophomores and juniors. Nabosny plays a lot on this defensive line for the Tornadoes. Second down and six. Knutson, the give once again, breaks. Breaks so quick. Gets across the 25 down to the 21-yard line before he's brought down by the Tornado secondary. First one to get to him was Austin Meyer.
One play, helmet came off.
Another sophomore over there on that defense as Austin Meyer comes up and makes the play. There's Breaks again.
Yeah, just a shifty player. He's got good speed. We saw it, the last big play. He's got a little bit of power. He's a good player. Unfortunately, if you're Anoka, you really can't key off of him because of how they gouged you with that fullback dive the entire game.
Yeah, they've had some success stopping the fullback dive here in the second half, but now they're attacking the edges.
Now, you talked about that earlier with needing to just kind of take something away.
There's Sather on the carry there. He'll take it all the way down across the 10 to the 5, and they're inside the 4 or 5-yard line. First down, goal to go for White Bear as they're looking for potentially the knockout punch that they thought they had early. Now they're going to try to go for it here late in this third quarter. They'll spot the ball. It starts running again inside a minute in what has been a lightning-fast third quarter.
Well, we got to make up for a little bit of lost time here with how long that first half took.
Oh, exactly. We're not going to get half-price appetizers at this point. It's going to be too late.
I need my mozzarella sticks.
You sir. Up to the line of scrimmage, first down and goal. They mark it at the 4-yard line. Lipscomb in the backfield. We'll get the carry, straight ahead run, and he's up near the goal line. It's close, down at the 1-yard line. And that will probably take us to the end of this third quarter. They might be content to just switch sides of the field here.
Yeah, just again, that power up the middle for White Bear Lake. Anoka unable to do a whole lot to stop it when they're worried about the edges too. So it just feels like, the defense might be getting a little bit gassed here too. They've been on the field a lot in this third quarter.
Pretty much the entire third quarter as it comes to an end right there. We'll have a critical second and goal coming up when we return on QCTV.
Stem is precise, no margin for error.
Dare to forget that. Dare to have fun with it. Get weird with it. Dare to send those old STEM theories flying past the neighbor's house into outer space. Dare to program something internet-breaking, record-breaking. Dare to blow their minds. Dare to learn the difference between sedimentary and metamorphic rock. Go find those rocks. Dare to keep daring. Dare to STEM. Check out She Can STEM to get started.
Jason, let's go see your room.
On QCTV, big second down and goal. They hand it off straight ahead, and they'll get it. Touchdown, White Bear Lake. Right out of the timeout, they hustled to the line, couldn't wait to run that play, and they get in the end zone for a quick score. Cole Sather will pick up the touchdown for White Bear Lake. And a flag on the play, though. Let's see about that call. Late flag there. Didn't see it. As you see, scores flashing on the bottom of the screen.
Dead ball penalty, 88. Offense. Taunting.
Ooh.
Gonna be a 15-yard penalty. Kickoff on the kickoff.
Yeah, so they think they're gonna go kickoff with that one. So an unsportsmanlike, a taunting call. And a lot of, you know, I will say White Bear, they played very well. I mean, they played very well. They may have made a lot of these kind of silly plays tonight. A lot of these kinds of things.
Yeah, we talked a little bit before the game, you know, that this could be a little chippy. You know, that this team's met last year.
And a little heat.
A little bit of heat here, not a ton. It's not like the rivals or anything, but you know, there's something to prove here.
Extra point, good. It's 42 to 20. We'll take a look at the taunt at the end from 88. As, yeah, that's going to do it every time. And it's just silly. I just don't understand what Josh Dogger was trying to do right there with that as you get a look at the touchdown.
Yeah, it's 42 to 20. Just kind of act like you've been there, right? You know, you're winning the game.
And it's a frustrating penalty because you feel like that touchdown can help, you know, maybe put it away. But now you got to kick off from way in your own territory.
Right.
You're going to give up good field position again because Anoka's been great on kick return. And so, like, you know, you're right back into the fire even though you should be feeling more comfortable. It's going to be tight again.
Absolutely. And once again, we know Anoka can score quickly, Ryan, right? They have shown the ability to do that here in this game. A quick score under with a minute or something like that. If you can go on a very quick drive, and you're going to be throwing, so you're trying to prolong the game as long as you can by passing. The more possessions you can get your hands on here in this fourth quarter, you can stay in the game.
Yeah, and again, we talked about this at the kind of the middle of that first half too, toward the end of the first quarter. You know, the defense has been on the field a lot. If you can just give them a little bit of a break here, they've shown that the ability to stop the run. If you can give them some time to get some water, get a break, and talk and make adjustments on the screens. You know, this penalty could be take a little bit of the wind out of the sails a little bit if you're White Bear, if Anoka can come down and score again.
So welcome back to the game. If you're just joining us, we're here at Goodrich Field. It's the 83rd Pumpkin Bowl, last home game of the season for the Anoka Tornadoes. It's 42-20 White Bear Lake in what was just a wild first half, a little calmer second half here so far. A recent score here from White Bear Lake puts them up 42-20. Tim Anderson, Ryan Nelson, Kane, Zach Kneeneighbor. Another short kickoff. It's going to be great field position for the Tornadoes right at midfield. White Bears coverage team able to surround the kick returner there as the up man was able to take it across midfield to the 49-yard line. That's number 83 for the Tornadoes. That's Alexander Wimmer. Hey, a junior. What a surprise. Another non-senior making a play for the Tornadoes in this game.
Probably getting talked to right now. Looks like Coach Bazal down there telling him, hey, you catch that ball, get down. There's no need to try and play hero ball there.
But they're at the 50-yard line. We'll see. When Peyton Padani's had time, he's been very effective tonight, but they have been coming after him, dialing up a lot of blitzes and kind of sitting on his cadence tonight. They peer in, look for the call from Coach Bo. And now they're ready to go. They shift Mossman. Padani waits. We'll take it on a handoff. Little give draw to Mossman to try to keep that defense honest. We'll pick up a couple 2-3 yards.
Yeah, the first half, they didn't get a whole lot of pressure on Padani, and he kind of picked them apart a little bit, was able to hit some of those throws over the backside. Now you wonder what the adjustment offensively that Anoka's going to make. They've got four sophomores on their offensive line, though obviously the one senior returning is that left tackle, big position there. Can they make these adjustments and kind of give him more time back there?
So Padani waits for it. Here comes the pressure on second down. A little out route complete to Eli Paulson. He'll take it near the 40. That's up near the first down territory. But I think this is where White Bears made a nice adjustment, Zach, in the sense that they've kind of taken those deep routes away and have forced him to throw these kind of shorter out patterns.
Yeah, I think you want to make them drive the field, right? We saw the first half was only two first downs, right? They had more touchdowns than first downs.
Yeah.
And that's because of the big play.
Third down and one. Obviously, picking up this first down is paramount, and you want to do it right here. 11 minutes and 16 seconds to play in the game. Down 42-20. They'll go Mossman on a quick draw. He'll get the first down and more. He'll break a couple tackles and cross the 20 to the 15-yard line, down to the 13. Nice run from Mossman as he's able to get some breathing room for this Tornadoes offense.
It's really the first time we've seen Anoka be able to effectively run the ball at all tonight. Obviously, they've been focusing more on the pass, but that kind of run can open it up for you, too.
Padani will step up, throw it. He's going end zone with it over the top, and it's just over and incomplete as they look for a Beckway that time on the far side. And that's really the difference. You're right, Ryan. In this offense from a year ago to now, Wes Lauber was their big running back last year, and they worked in Tyrell Cummings. They had these nice little 1-2 punches. Now they kind of need some of that. They need those punches.
Yeah, they're looking for juice a little bit here, and you've kind of found it with your wide receivers a little bit. They're, you know, and it helps to have a quarterback that can make some tough throws. That we saw that quick out to Eli Paulson on second down. That's a tough throw for a young quarterback to make, especially with the timing. You know, they kind of gave it to him a little bit, but it's physically difficult to make across the field like that. So now we're starting to see him hit a rhythm again. You know, he missed that throw, but he got the right read, that one-on-one coverage on the outside. Can he come back and do it again and maybe hit a big play?
I think they got the defense to jump there on that little move.
Yep, you know, Wiper's been trying to time it up all game and finally caught him there.
The interesting thing about that, some teams do this, right, where they have all the offensive skill guys looking back at the coach. We see this sometimes at high school levels and at different places. When you're looking at that defensively, what is the purpose of that, and what are you looking at with that?
Well, the offense is looking to see what the defense shows, and then they're calling their play based on that. Defensively, there are times where you will change then. Whatever you had called, you will change. When the offense looks, the defense should look too, and you can get it out of something or into something else.
There's pressure coming. Padani trying to get away. He's in some trouble, and he runs into his own guy and falls down. And that will be a loss of a few yards there. Set up third down and five. Or actually longer than that, about third and ten now, back to the original line of scrimmage.
I continue to be I know he took a sack on this play, but I continue to be impressed with his ability to keep his eyes down the field and try to move up into the pocket there. Really, I mean, it's kind of one of those intangible things you see with a quarterback. He's not freezing in the face of pressure. He's trying to find a way out of it while keeping his eyes downfield for opportunity. It's a really nice look for a sophomore. You know when he's got two more years in this offense to try and, you know, learn the other stuff that comes along with being a starting quarterback.
If I was White Bear, I'd know where Paulson is on this play here.
Absolutely. Paulson lined up, stacked to the near side. Back to pass, Padani on a rollout. Here comes pressure. Can he get it away? Tries to turn the corner. He will throw it, and it's incomplete as he was being chased all the way down to the end and knocked out of bounds, but he was able to throw it. Incomplete. Late flag. Late flag here. They throw it on the back end. What is this call? Maybe a late hit on Padani? I'm not sure, but that's a late flag.
Sideline warning on the defense.
Oh. Sideline warning on the defense, so no yardage there. That's interesting.
Big third down here for Anoka. You got to get it down to about the 10-yard or 5-yard line there.
Yeah, you got to get, it's about the 6, maybe 5, 6. And it's fourth down now. Yep, so this is fourth down and 10 after that.
They didn't change the sticks yet.
Yeah, they changed the sticks just now, just not the scoreboard. So fourth and 10, they set it up at the 15, and this is really the ballgame for Anoka. They got to punch this in and keep this possession alive. You don't want to give it away here. 9 minutes, 47 seconds to go. Tornadoes want to make a run. It's got to be right now. Padani looks back at Coach Wasserick for the call. He'll take it. Back to pass, pressure from the outside. They run a screen, and that's going to get blown up. And Padani really didn't have much choice there. They were coming after him on the outside. Nowhere to go with that one, and they turn it over on downs.
Well, it looked like White Bear was a man there, and they had someone assigned to the running back, and he didn't get sucked in. He read it well, and it's a good play by White Bear.
Wonderful job of pursuit. Coming off the edge there, untouched, was Aiden Akins, the outside linebacker, and I think that forced the play for Padani there to get that out quick.
Yeah, we're going to look back at this game, and obviously we're going to talk about the punt in the first half that Anoka nearly got on with the dropped snap, but... You know, the two fourth downs in plus territory, deep in opposing territory. I mean, you're down three scores. You have to have that. You have to be able to move the ball there, and they just haven't been able to execute that tonight.
It's a little bit of the season microcosm for the Tornadoes here, where you see flashes of stuff you really like, right? And that's what Coach Poe said to me before the game. Talked about there's a lot of things we're doing, but we're kind of also doing stuff to ourselves, beating ourselves in moments as well, and we're seeing that tonight play itself out in real time, a microcosm of the entire season for the Tornadoes.
And now the clock is your enemy. We're under, you know, under 10, and it's going to be running the whole time, right?
Yep.
Because we've seen White Bears going to be committed to run the ball, especially now up a couple scores.
Absolutely.
And yeah, we will not see another pass, I'm sure, from Knutson. Instead, you'll get a handoff here, and it might be breaks again on that counterplay that's been very effective.
Just to neatly tie off Tim's point here about the shooting themselves in the foot a little bit. That's kind of an issue that young teams have. You've got to learn to handle these situations a little bit, and Anoka probably just needs a little bit more seasoning, a little bit more time on the field, but they clearly have athletic talent. They can clearly hang with these teams and play some good football. It's just a matter of getting more time, getting more coaching, watching more film, just doing more fundamental stuff.
There's a lot to like again, and coming across the line, that's going to be an encroachment here, it looks like, as well on Anoka. As Anoka tries to make a play. Yeah, a little sloppier in the second half.
Dead ball penalty, encroachment. Defense, number 99, 5-yard penalty, first down.
And that'll move up to an automatic first down. You see, again, scores across the bottom of the screen from not only in the metro, but from around the outer edges of the metro. Waconee and Chanhassen there at the bottom in the second half in a 21-21 game. A lot of tight games getting played here. Back to pass, Knutson looking, throwing, caught. It's Vatel Henderson. Little surprise they're throwing, but they do complete a pass there. Henderson, first time getting one in this one. He's been open a few times. They've thrown it to him, and that time he's able to finally get a completion. So they'll get another first down as nice, they keep it inbounds.
Nice throw there from Knutson. Obviously, you just want to keep that inbounds, just keep the clock running as much as you can. But yeah, I'm a little surprised they're throwing too, but... You know, you do what you can to move the ball down the field. Never trust a lead, especially in a situation like this where anything can happen in high school football.
See that score at the bottom. Stillwater up two scores on Forest Lake in the second half, 27-14. Keeping your eye on some of these big games that are happening late in the season. Second down, keeping the clock moving here as we are under 8 minutes at Goodrich Field tonight.
Be interested to see if we can get an update on that Maple Grove-Wyzetta game. Wyzetta was up two scores earlier in the day.
Well, that's when our guy in the truck, Taylor's got to make some phone calls. You know, he's got to use his pull and his connections, and I'm sure we'll get on top of that. Second and five, Knutson sits in the shotgun. And again, another little quick out to Vatel Henderson, and that's incomplete. Interesting stuff from White Bear late in this game.
Well, we know they're capable of throwing, right? We've
Certainly.
Seen him throw the ball well a couple times this year.
Threw it for 380 yards last week.
But, yeah, interesting that they're deciding to air it out more now with the current game situation.
And I'm sure if you're Coach Bo, you don't mind it because you'd love to have more time if you can get the ball back and throw it some more.
Absolutely.
But third down now in five. And obviously if you pick this up, and maybe that's because you have such confidence in your running game to pick up 5 yards, it doesn't matter. But we'll see. Handoff again, it's Lipscomb, who has just been a workhorse tonight doing just that. He's going to be, looks like, just short of the first down, maybe a half yard to a yard short, setting up fourth down in plus territory.
Do you think you go for it here, but do you take the three-score lead and just pin him deep?
You know, it looks like they're bringing... well, I'm not sure what they're bringing out
Knutson
here.
Knutson stays on the field.
Yeah, it looks like they're going offensive here. I would go for it probably just because their punt team hasn't been very good.
Sure.
Yeah, you might as well. And you can get a yard. It feels like you can get a yard whenever you want.
They got their jumbo package in.
Yeah, this is a big package here. Following behind one of the big daddies, and they're going to pick that up no problem. They just go ahead and wheel in number 75. It looked like Joel Volker, I think. I'm trying to see the name on that. But that was 74 was the number. I don't have that 74, but man, I might just I'll say Joe Volk. Why not? Just call it out. Just say it. They bring in a big lineman and they just run right behind a classic play right there.
Right. I mean, it almost feels like you have to go for it there because they struggled on punt. Right. You had a bad snap. What the worst thing that could happen is you get a punt blocked, a punt return. Right. Sure. Even if they get stopped, it's still ball at midfield. I don't.
And ball's been at midfield all day anyway. It's not like it's unfamiliar territory.
Boy, Knutson going for a home run ball here. Has a guy open, dropped, incomplete.
Excellent coverage there by number 24.
There was some on their final there, 28-21. Maple Grove coming back to beat Wyzetta at the end to stay 6-0. Thanks to our guys at CCX once again for giving us that live look.
Well, they're the number one team in the state for a reason right now. Playing a good game there.
Boy, that was a wild one out there. Wyzetta had the early lead. Maple Grove made the comeback.
Yeah, Wyzetta's been playing a lot better here in the second half of the year. They struggled early, but
kind of another young team this year, right?
Yeah, they've started to find some success.
Second down and 10. After the incomplete home run ball, they go straight ahead. Sather, and he will pick up another 8 yards or so. And he's a nice little change-up fullback as well. They've got Lipscomb, who's pretty fast. Sather's also fast, but also gives them just another wrinkle, another guy who can really move.
Yeah, anytime you have a second back you can set back there, you've got an opportunity to give your bell cow a breather a little bit, let him get a little bit of water in his system and run the ball a little bit more efficiently down the stretch. So, more weapons is never a bad thing for an offense, especially when you're trying to grind the clock down late in a game.
5 minutes, 40 seconds, another handoff for Sather. He'll go straight ahead, and now just imposing their will is this White Bear Lake offensive line, as they have pretty much all game long. And they're continuing to do what it is they've been very successful at here in this game. Ryan Bartlett's team looking like they are on their way to 4-2 in the Metro Maroon.
And you and I said this last year when we came to Anoka for that section game against Mounds View, that this Anoka team does feel like a team that the program's getting better. There's clearly some athletic talent here. You can be disappointed about 1-5 all you like as this game starts to wind down, and obviously there's still a little bit of time for them to come back. But if they lose this game and slide to 1-5, you've got some things to build on into next year, and you've still got some section play that you can think about a little bit. But this was a game that you really wanted to have with you at home. It's kind of a second homecoming game here with the Pumpkin Bowl. It's tough to lose this game, especially the way you lost it.
We're thinking probably, we've got to be looking at Lipscomb, somebody like that for player of the game. And obviously, if you can co-player it with breaks, I'd like those two together tonight have been really the MVPs of this one for this White Bear Lake team. Another straight-ahead run. And
really credit to that White Bear Lake offensive line, too, just continuing to blow open hole after hole and move this Anoka defense around. There's just been room all up and down the field for this running game for White Bear Lake all night tonight.
It's Keyshawn Lipscomb there again, who just a terrific night for him. And they run it inside now to the 13-yard line, under 5 minutes to play, as some of the student sections starting to file out here tonight.
Well, it's been a long drive too, right? Sucking up a lot of clock here.
Which is exactly what they were hoping to accomplish, try to get out here in this second half if they can. Hand off up the middle. And that will be blown up at the line of scrimmage by the Tornado. They might have the football, they say, but we'll see what the call is here as they wait. That ball may have came out at the end, but they're going to say he was down, it looks like. Yep, down, says the official. So we'll keep it moving here with second down. So the clock stops, I believe, temporarily just because of the I don't know why the clock stopped. Now they're saying wind it. Yep, here we go. And they're winding that clock one more time. Second down and 10. Breaks comes off the field quickly.
Expecting more running. They're just going to keep running the ball here.
And there's Matt Currier, who's going to get a carry this time. He'll take it inside the 10 down to the 8-yard line.
We talked about this rushing attack as kind of a three-headed monster here for White Bear. Have not seen a whole lot of Currier tonight, but then again, they really haven't needed him much.
No, they've gotten what they've wanted between the tackles. And when they have gone outside, it's been breaks.
Yeah, and we talked about, Coach Bartlett was talking early in before the game about how it's not about balance. They're going to run the ball, and they had over 300 yards in the first half, and it's been more of the same in the second.
Keep people moving. They will give it on an outside counter once again, and that's blown up at the line as they give it to somebody different this time. It's Henry Wilkinson who comes in to get that carry, and he was dragged down behind the line, sets up fourth down.
And looking like some of the backup runners coming in, other than Courier here, maybe getting breathers to the guys who've been running all over tonight. You know, you're up three scores with 3 minutes to go. There's no need to risk unnecessary injury, especially if you think you can compete in this section.
So again, on the road go the Tornadoes after this. They have next week and then obviously the big paddle game in 2 weeks against Champlain Park.
White Bears are going to take this all the way down and take a timeout. And then you might see the field goal unit come on.
They do take that timeout.
White Bear takes their
final timeout
of the second half. Field goal,
field goal. So they do, I think we can kind of hear field goal background on the microphone, so it looks like they're going to go try to kick this thing, go up 45-20.
Barring any kind of block or miscue here, because we've seen that their special teams unit can be a problem here. Of course, with 2 minutes left, if any kind of life is going to come from Anoka, it's probably going to come from a block on this field goal.
Yeah, but I still like the decision to kick it because you just don't kick a ton of field goals in high school, so it's absolutely always good to get the operation going in a game situation with a rush on, you know, because there will be a time where you may need to kick a game-winning field goal or one with a lot of pressure on you, and at least you've gone out and done it a few times here in season.
And you have the cushion, too, if something does go catastrophically wrong here where you're not worried about losing the game on this.
Big final there as it's official as Stillwater continues their winning ways. A nice win over Forest Lake tonight, 27-14.
A little bit of a battle at the top of the division there.
And it's, again, not to undo what's been a very good season for this for that Forest Lake squad. Very proud of those kids over there. They got to be just thrilled over there in the city of Forest Lake. Field goal opportunity coming. Kicker Eli Treichel. It's down. It's on its way. And it is good. That'll get it to 45-20 with 2 minutes and 42 seconds left to play in this one. And it's looking good for White Bear Lake. And again, they opened up hot. They got a couple big plays early, went up 7-0, got a backward pass fumble on the Tornadoes. They scooped and scored for 14. They got up 21 rip before 4 or 5 minutes went off the clock. Credit the Tornadoes for battling back and making it a game in that first half. White Bear Lake, next up, they're going to host Osseo on the 14th, and then host Totino Grace to wind down their regular season schedule. The Tornadoes are going to Park Cottage Grove and then at Champlain Park to close out, as we mentioned, in the battle for the paddle, which has kind of become a traditional end-of-season game. Some upcoming broadcasts on QCTV. I'll be at Anoka on Thursday for Champlain Park and Anoka, that a very improved young Anoka team against a very good Champlain Park team. Monticello and Andover for football. Also Cambridge Isanti and Andover coming up in the next couple of weeks. And then finally the paddle game will be on QC as well on the 20th. So back-to-back nights of football on the 19th and the 20th. Oh boy, as they like to say. They'll kick this one. Not too deep for Eli Paulson anyway, as he makes a couple of moves out to the 30 to the 32-yard line before he's finally brought down. Some shoving after the play on the White Bear sideline, but that looks to be over and done with. The Cheers theme song now playing overhead at Goodrich. Again, file that under things you just don't expect to hear when you go to the football game. I'm waiting for somebody to yell Norm or something in the out of the press box. We'll see what that happens.
Well, you know what they say, Tim. Sometimes you do want to go where everyone knows your name.
Yeah, how many kids have seen one episode of Cheers out of our school?
1%.
Maybe less than that. All right, 2:36 to go as we wrap things up here at Goodrich. Padani trying to make something happen. He's getting chased hard, and he gets hit as he throws it incomplete. He is just buried on that. Again, that line, but seems like those linebackers are coming in untouched from the outside, Zach.
Yep, that's Aiden Adkins off the edge, and you just don't have a way to account for that guy when you're booting away. And Wiper Lake has had some success with that tonight.
Well, the way you counter it is you got to get rid of the football if you're going to roll out that far. It's a quick release. You know the pressure's coming. Get rid of it. Don't second guess. And if you don't have anything, know enough to throw it away. That's just a young quarterback who's going to see that more and more. He just needs the experience there just to know, get the ball out of your hands before you're in trouble.
They go empty, and they're throwing.
What a ball.
Deep, and nobody home. Going over the top, trying to find Mossman on the outside, but Padani, I think, wanted Paulson, but maybe they got crossed up on the route there because Paulson didn't stay with that route as they went.
Well, it was a pretty ball, Tim, and it didn't quite get in the hands of anybody, but at least it looked nice.
Well, that was the comment I got from when I talked to Coach Hale earlier this week about Padani. They said that, he throws a great ball. For a sophomore, he's got a finesse game. He can throw with some touch. He's got a nice deep ball that he throws. There's a lot they like about Peyton Padani.
We've seen a number of flashes from him tonight where he's looked pretty good on a couple of these plays. I think about that slant pass to Paulson down near the goal stripe. I mean, he's made some plays for you here. You need to get him a little more experience, and I think he could be decent for you in the future here.
Another quick out, that time missing Avi Abekwe as he throws it behind him. And that brings up third down, yeah.
And the jump to varsity football is a huge jump from whatever level you come from, right? Whether you played JV to varsity or if you're on a sophomore team or whatever. But if you're coming from a freshman and all of a sudden you're playing in varsity football games, I mean, there are so many things that are coming at you from a defense. There's so many more adjustments and things you need to read and the speed of the game. And so it's a big step up. And he's going to grow over the next couple of years. And I mean, and whatever they do at quarterback with both those guys, they've got some talent there.
Yeah, for a fourth start here tonight, I've been really impressed by Peyton Padani.
He'll run it to the outside here. He's in trouble. He's got to go. And he throws it to nobody in particular. So that one will fall incomplete, and that will take it to...
That's the turnover
on downs. Yeah, that'll be it for that. So they try to make a play there. Padani tries to get rid of it, but nobody home. So they turn it over in a possession that just didn't amount to much there. Take a look here at the fan of the game here at QCTV. And that's our group of young elementary school kids hanging out early on who are all about getting on camera. Yes, that was exactly what Zachney Neighbor looked like when I told him, hey, we're going to come up here and do a three-man booth tonight. How excited is that? Did that exact same reaction. That was great. That was pretty close, right?
I think yeah, that was about my reaction when I got the text message.
Oh, man. It's been fun here, though, tonight at Goodrich. A lot of points. Oh, look at this. Into the game now. Number 9. Can't get a number. I don't have a number on this, but she is in the game, and we're very excited to see that. I wish I had a name here. I'm going to have to go yell at somebody at White Bear Lake.
Probably just seeing a number of handoffs here. I don't think we're going to see much other than that, but nice to see some young kids.
This is really fantastic. Into the game now is...
Yeah, we're under 2 minutes, right? I mean...
This is just about getting some time out on the field here.
Heidi Barber, who was listed as 35 on my chart, but Heidi Barber is actually going to be wearing number 9 here. And she's in the game handing the ball off as the backup quarterback. So Heidi Barber, junior quarterback, 5'11". Just getting calls from the coaches. And now we will finish it off with a minute 20 to go. And Barber will take him to the line. I'm going to wind the play clock as long as possible here. And now sits for it in the shotgun and hands it off. 97, getting all the fun numbers in here as Avian Atkins gets the carry. At least I thought. Is that 97? That's what it looked like.
Sure was.
So everybody getting a look now.
Just winding down the game here. Gonna just let her go here. This one's been done for about 15 minutes here, really after that last touchdown by White Bear Lake to put it away. A good game played by White Bear Lake here. I thought Anoka battled really well early on, and it just kind of got away from here in the second half.
They got behind the eight ball early, which seems to be the problem. And they just could not make it all the way back, even though it looked like they were. Big handoff there trying to get to the outside. We'll get a first down and what most likely will be the last play of the game. I'm going to assume that they'll spot the ball, start the clock, and leave it right there.
Well, we had 55 points scored in the first half.
Yeah.
And just 10 here in the second half.
Yeah, things sort of calmed down here in this second half, but it was a big game for White Bear Lake. They came out early. Clock's going to run down to zero. It was a really fun game here in this in the first half for sure at Goodrich. White Bear Lake ends up winning, going away tonight, 45-20. Some last-minute thoughts from you guys, Zach. How about we'll start with you?
I think it was a lot of fun to watch both these teams compete tonight. We saw a lot of good things from Anoka, right? We know they're young and they're growing, but they're going to be good, right? They've got a lot of good things happening, and it just takes a little time.
Yeah, I mean, on the other side of the ball, White Bear Lake played just a really, really good game. There's obviously some things they need to clean up here, but they're more experience showed on their side here. You're running the ball really, really well. Obviously, last week you played a really tight, emotional game against a Stillwater team that is showing to be pretty darn good. So there's a lot of talent on this White Bear team. If they can clean up some of the mistakes they made tonight, they kind of played. I thought they played down a little bit at times to Anoka, who I don't think was quite as talented as White Bear Lake. But they're both really good teams. They're both going places. Maybe not this year for Anoka, but both these teams are gonna be good down the stretch here.
Player of the game coming up here for QCTV. We'll take a look at who they picked in the truck, or play of the game, I should say. And here it was, a play of the game for Lipscomb, who had a big breakaway touchdown early on. It looked like he was going to score on it. He's also our player of the game tonight, and you could see he was just all over the field in the first half. He was everywhere. He was making big plays for them. There's another handoff touchdown. It just seemed like whenever they needed a big gain, they went to number 28 tonight, and they got it.
Yep, he definitely had a bunch of yards on the ground and was the spark for the offense.
And so a big win. Want to thank our guys in the truck and all the guys who braved it on the field tonight, our camera crew who does such a great job for us here at QCTV. We got our guy Mike in the truck, got our guy Taylor in the truck, everybody doing all that great stuff. Andy putting the time in. Want to thank everybody for working hard tonight in the elements here at Goodrich Field. We had a great time. Want to thank my guy Ryan Nelson Kane, my guy Zach Nienaber for coming out and helping me out tonight. And on behalf of everybody else here at QCTV and QCTV.org, this is Tim Anderson saying keep your head up, and we'll see you next time.